Just six races left in the regular season for the NASCAR Cup Series. Today, the Tricky Triangle, Pocono Raceway. Not only one of NASCAR's biggest tracks, but also hands down one of the biggest challenges as well. Welcome everyone to Countdown to Green, presented by Sonic from the Pocono Mountains. On tap today, what many consider the most challenging race left in the regular season for the NASCAR Cup Series. The Peacock Pit Box located in pit stall number one. Perfect view because we expect pit road to be a major factor in today's race. Hi, everyone. Marty Snyder, Kyle Petty, and Steve Letard, our crew chief, joining you here. So, Steve, we always hear the conversation about how Pocono is such a difficult racetrack. Why?
Well, it only has three corners. It should be easier, right? You're lacking a corner. Well, it's anything but, because the three corners are just so dramatically different. Turn one should be relatively straightforward. A lot of banking, a lot of corner. We've seen Chris Buescher have issues. The bumps in the tunnel will be a conversation all day long. Chase Elliott found out the hard way, as well as other cars. It's rough when you get back to the gas. It's easy to go around. Turn three should be straightforward, but it has to be the most important because it leads to the longest straightaway. And Kyle, that's just the racetrack. We haven't even talked strategy. Strategy is like putting a puzzle together with no edge pieces.
Yeah.
You know how you start on the edge, work your way in? There's no edge pieces here at Pocono. You just start from the middle. Good luck.
Yeah, and as a driver, I only got three corners. So say I got it easy. I don't have to worry.
Right.
But what kills me are the restarts here.
Yeah.
The start of the race is the calmest time they will ever come to the green. After that is who's got two tires, who's got four tires, who's up front. And then you have the restart into turn one, and you got to have the whole racetrack, don't you, Denny? And you use up everything you get when you get down there, and this is what ensues. It is five or six wide sometimes, funneling into that very first corner. Restarts are going to be critical here today and exciting.
Well, one driver has taken the challenge of this 2023 season and made it look very easy at times is Martin Truex Jr., who claimed his third win of the season on Monday in New Hampshire.
We've led laps, dominated races, and it just would never all come together.
597 days since Martin Truex Jr. went to a victory lane.
Hell yeah, buddy!
You just keep fighting. You never give up on it. You always believe in each other.
He goes to victory lane on the Monster Mile.
Burn them down, man.
Martin Truex Jr. is going to win in dominating fashion.
Damn right, boys. Finally got that damn lobster. Hell yeah, boys.
Been after this one a long time. This one's sweet.
Yeah, it's been an incredible year for Martin Truex Jr. and some comments you made last week about a boat. It's got a lot of people scratching their heads that if you buy the boat, that retirement was in the future. So, one, have you gotten the boat? And can you not race and have the boat?
I can do both.
Yeah.
I could. Yeah, I'm going to look at it tomorrow. So, I didn't buy it yet, but I'm pretty excited about it.
Speaking from experience, you can race and have the boat at the same time. Look, last year you guys had good speed, but just wasn't able to win races. This year, good speed again, but winning races. What's the difference?
Well, I think we have a lot more speed than we had last year. Last year, we had to do everything perfect. If the balance was off a little bit or we made one mistake, we couldn't recover. You know, now we've got so much more speed. We're unloading better. We understand this car a whole lot more than we did last year. And honestly, just everybody at JGR is building better cars. So it's been fun to drive them. Great starting spot for today. You got to be up front here, I feel like, you know, and have a good pit stall to be able to win this race. And we're right where we need to be. So we'll see what we can do with it.
I know winning races is obviously what you show up for, but now that you're at this point in the season, you're sort of separating yourself from some of the other competitors. There's a couple of you that are emerging as playoff championship contenders. Is it all about stage points and building that cushion to be able to launch you through the playoffs further?
Yeah, 100%. I mean, race wins are 5 points, so we're always looking at that, obviously, and then stage wins. Anything we can do to get bonus points right now is what it's all about.
I take the buying the boat as a good sign because he will have to keep racing to pay for that thing. Them things are expensive. Good luck today, Martin.
That's a terrific point, Junior. I didn't even think about it from that standpoint. But to the point they were making, it's so much better this year for Martin Truex Jr. Kyle, at 43, is Martin Truex Jr. better than he's ever been?
You know, I want to say no, but I have to say in some ways yes, because I think he's a lot smarter race car driver than he was before. And I think he's in a better place personally. When you look at him, he's so relaxed, man. He's relaxed before these races. Let's go back to 17 when he won 8 races. Let's go back to 19 when he won 7 races. There's times he won lots of races, but he didn't seem comfortable. Martin Truex seems comfortable in his skin right now. So I have to say, mentally, physically, when you got a boat, you're in a good place, man. You're in a good place.
All right, speaking of the boat, Steve, so Junior brought it up twice, the retirement conversation. Now, what point, though, to the race team in 2023 does that become a distraction?
Well, as long as you're running well and winning, it's not a distraction. Don't tell the 19 team. Don't tell Martin Truex Jr. Look, they've won three of the last 10 races. And back to Kyle's point, I look back at that winless streak. Questions about his retirement. Questions about could he do it. He misses the playoffs. 54 races without a win. When they won at Dover, everything became more fun. Everything became easier. A driver having fun is the most dangerous driver in the field.
I think in the next 2 weeks we get an answer on that front as to whether he's coming back in 2024 or not. We'll see. But Martin Truex Jr. is worried about the regular season title. Kyle, these drivers are worried about making the playoffs.
Yeah, if we look at these guys, you look at the ones on that end trying to make the playoffs, but I want to look at the other end. I always do. William Byron, Martin Truex, we just talked about him. Kyle Busch, these guys with multiple wins, four, three wins, they are so close in points. The regular season championship means something. We keep wanting to talk about getting to the playoffs. That regular season championship and those bonus points are critical.
And that bubble, certainly the attention over the next 6 weeks. Bubba Wallace on it right now. Plus two above the cut line. He's with Parker Kligerman.
Right, Marty. A whopping 2 points into the playoffs right now. How do you approach this race being so close to the playoff bubble? What goes through your mind as you go into a race like this?
Well, you don't make mistakes like I did yesterday in qualifying. That's a start.
I can see that.
Maybe I'll take that into next week. But no, our car is really fast. We've had minimal damage from the wall contact yesterday, so still should be okay. Proud of the effort that we're putting in, though. It's nice to come here in a short week where you don't get much prep time, and you're on top of the board for practice, or around top of the board and qualifying there. So it's nice to have that. You feel like, you know, you, Booty said it. He's like, I feel like we're going to hit the ground running when we get into this weekend. So we got to continue to do that. I know we got some tough tracks coming up, particularly road courses. I need to hang out with you, I guess. But we got some good tracks coming up too. So we just got to keep a level mindset, not let the highs get too high, lows get too low, and just go have fun.
Keeping their head in the game, Kim.
Well, Parker, Michael McDowell holds the very last playoff spot, just plus one to the good. So how can you channel pressure to help you? And on the flip side, how can pressure hinder you?
Yeah, just don't really worry about it. 6 weeks is a long time in our sport. A lot can change. We just got to keep hammer down like we've been doing, keep executing. Really proud of everybody at Front Row. We've had a good month. The Spin-A-Bone Ford Mustang was good yesterday. We still need a little bit of speed, but it's going to be hot and slick out there. We'll see what we can do, but it's all about not making mistakes. And those last 3 weeks, I think we'll be in a good spot if we can get there.
Michael McDowell rolls up in the 15th position, Parker.
Daniel Suarez comes in this Pocono race, an odd man out of the playoffs right now by a whopping 1 point. So how do you approach this race that close to the playoff bubble?
That's nothing, man. And I mean, really, how many races we have left? Six or something like that? Like, there is so many things. And two road course races in there. There's a lot that is going to happen. So we just have to stay calm, do our thing. It's not the first time I've been in this situation, so we already know how things work. We just have to go out there, take care of one race at a time, and we should be good. The car so far, honestly, has felt better than the speed that we have shown. So I'm confident that the car is going to race pretty well.
Marty, I don't think it's on his mind as he was just checking our point standing here on the monitor to see exactly where he stacked up. I don't think he's focusing on that too much right now.
He's keeping up with it, trust me. So, Kyle, Daniel Suarez, I know the focus is the playoffs, but yes. He's on the hot seat for his ride as well, maybe?
I think it's got to be in the back of his mind and the back of the leadership's mind at Trackhouse, especially when Ross Chastain wins at Nashville, Ben Gasbergen wins at Chicago. Yeah. Those are his cars. That's his equipment. That's his stuff. Daniel needs to just take a breath, back it down, and do what he can do. Everybody knows I'm a big fan of Daniel Suarez. He just needs to drive and do what he knows he can do, and the points will come.
Steve, is Michael McDowell getting enough credit for the job he's done this year?
Well, I think when I look at the total points earned, it's very similar to last year, but here's the difference. Making his 450th start, he knows what 6 weeks feels like. Here are the teams that Front Row are currently beating. Two Hendrick cars, a Gibbs car, a Penske car, three Stewart Haas Racing Fords, an RCR car, all behind him in the playoffs. It's time that Michael McDowell in Front Row starts to get the credit on where they are in this playoff leaderboard.
When we come back, is Chase Elliott now in must-win territory if he wants to make the playoffs? Steve and Kyle will discuss that next. You know, Pocono Raceway, just a small part of the terrific sports scene in Pennsylvania. Between all the professional sports in Pittsburgh and Philadelphia, throw in Penn State as well. Think about what Philly fans were treated to last year. The Phillies making the World Series, Eagles in the Super Bowl, MLS as well. And now for 49 years, the summer tradition of NASCAR racing in the Poconos.
For 75 years, you've been here with us. Fans of names and numbers, of family and flags, of sights and sounds and speed. Fans of going fast until there's no more race to run. So to all that love this sport as much as we do, thank you for showing up. Thank you for your devotion. From all of us at NASCAR, thank you.
Get more into the races with NASCAR Fantasy Live. To compete, make an entry by picking five drivers, then add a garage driver. You can keep tabs on your lineup and even make in-race adjustments to maximize your score. Visit NASCAR.com/fantasy to play.
Look out, guys. Look out, guys. Look out, guys.
He's going to savor this one, I have a feeling.
Alex Bowman is going to win at Pocono.
Unbelievable.
Kyle Busch is going to win at Pocono.
Let's go, boys! Woo!
Racing at Pocono, always unpredictable. Here's what's on the menu presented by Sonic. Big news coming this week from Rick Ware Racing, signing Justin Haley to a multi-year contract starting next year. Shane Vez Givbergen will be back. The winner from the streets of Chicago will drive for Trackhouse Racing once again, coming up at Indy in 3 weeks. And of course, time is running out in the regular season. Just 6 races left to set the Cup Series playoff field. So Steve, we saw the playoff points a moment ago. Let's break it down a little bit further on the bubble. And let's put some definition around these drivers.
Well, 11 drivers in yellow. I think it's fair to say we're not going to have 16 winners. So let's put them in some groups. First, it's the stay the course group. Harvick, Keselowski, Buescher, they're nearly 100 up over the next group. I think stay the course, do what you're doing. It's the middle group, the group on the cut line that I think is the most challenged. What are they doing? Bubba Wallace all the way to Allmendinger. They're racing for points, but they're racing for one spot or two spots. Remember, a new winner moves the cut line. This is awkward. And now if you're behind Allmendinger, you better be thinking win, Marty. There is no reason to even think points are an option. While math says you can do it, it's not just 41 points for Ty Gibbs. It's 41 points and 4 positions. That's a tall task for any driver.
So, Steve, with your must-win drivers, let's do a little on the clock and talk about those drivers and where that win might come from in the final 6 races of the regular season. Kyle, we'll start with you and Alex Bowman. Where could you see the 48 team winning before the playoffs?
Okay, he's won at Pocono before, and he's won at Richmond this week and next week. But I don't see him winning any other race this year. I don't see him winning one of these next 6. He doesn't have any top 10 since he's come back, and only 7, and it's only 7 stage points. So he's just not come back as strong as he was before his injury.
Well, the sophomore slump is real for Austin Cindric, but I think there are a couple tracks where they can circle. It starts at the Indy Road Course. 2nd a year ago, he's very good at the road courses. Why not Indy? And let's talk Daytona. The man has won the 500. If you've won the 500, then Daytona has to be on the horizon and circled for the 2 team.
All right, Ty Gibbs, exactly the opposite of Alex Bowman. I think Ty Gibbs can win here, and I think Ty Gibbs can win at Richmond. These are 2 races I have circled. This was his first race. He filled in for Kurt Busch. He has gotten comfortable in this car. He has gotten more mature as the year has gone on, and he has shown flashes where he can run up front and can win races.
Here, there, and everywhere. That's the answer for Chase Elliott. No chance. A man's won 18 races. I don't care what last week was. I don't care what 5 weeks was. He drives for Hendrick Motorsports. He's a champ. At any point, this 9 car could break through a victory lane, I think sooner rather than later.
Good stuff. So Chase Elliott could win any race left in the regular season. That's good. That, Steve. So, Kyle, let's talk about that. Yeah. He obviously missed the 7 races. You had the same exact experience, broke your leg at one point. How difficult is it to come back? And everybody expected to be plug and play, and it's not been for the 9 teams.
It's not plug and play. It's plug and play when you start at Daytona with everybody else. When you get out of that rhythm, there's a racing rhythm where you get used to going week in and week out to the racetrack. He got out of that rhythm with the injury. Then he came back, and he was just falling into the injury. to the rhythm when he had a suspension. Now he's a little bit lost. He's off sync with the rest of the field. And when you're off sync, you don't get back on. You feel like when you show up at the racetrack, you're behind. Physically and emotionally, you're in a bad place.
Well, if he's off sync, the best way to get on sync is to go to your inner circle. And for Chase Elliott, he doesn't look any further than the top of his pit box. Alan Gustafson has 38 wins with some of the biggest names in NASCAR. They have 261 starts together. Remember, talk about sync. They were the COVID champs. They were the champs in 2020 when nothing was straightforward.
When we come back, we'll hear from Brad Keselowski. Plus, Dell Jr. gives us his thoughts about the big wrecks that happened here at the Tricky Triangle. Countdown to Green is brought to you by Sonic. The Sonic 299 Strawberry Shortcake Snowball Slush Float for a limited time only at Sonic. Take your taste buds somewhere cool with the new Sonic 299 Strawberry Shortcake Snowball Slush Float, topped with ice cream and crunchy sugar crystals for a limited time only at Sonic. Sonic.
Pocono looks simple from its design, just a triangle. But since 1974, these sharp corners and long, I mean long straightaways, have led to some of the worst accidents in NASCAR.
Oh, he's upside down.
Whoa.
Man. Look at Richard.
One of my scariest wrecks occurred in 2002 with my teammate Steve Park.
Over on his lid, it's Park and Dale Jr.
A metal guardrail was all that kept us from flying into the infield.
Jr. is running to see his teammate, see if he's okay.
And thankfully, Steve was okay. Upgrades have made Pocono safer. But part failures at top speed still hurt. Broken brakes, hung throttles, and popped tires all cause painful hits. When a driver says they are lucky to walk away, they mean it.
Andy, all right?
Yeah, thank God.
But you have to take a car to the edge of out of control, down the long pond straight, and through the tunnel turn. If you're doing it right, you won't see the fans or the trees. You'll just simply fly right by them.
That's what you're talking about, no sleep.
And you gas it all the way to victory lane.
Hell yeah.
Powerful stuff from a driver who personally knows the good and bad of Pocono as well as anyone. Dale, does this track rank up there with Daytona and Talladega in terms of respect for the risk involved racing here?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, the long straightaways heading off into turn one, but even the long straightaway that's the long pond straightaway, that's a long straightaway in itself. In 1979, Dad broke both collarbones in that tunnel turn with a blown tire leading the race, and then came back in 1982, lost his brakes into turn one. 17 flips later, he had a broken leg. So early in his career, he had to put those things behind him every time he came back to this racetrack. And even if you've not been in a wreck at this racetrack, you have seen them. You've watched those impacts that we just watched in that piece, and you know what's capable of happening here, and you have to respect this racetrack. And so we'll see the drivers all day long trying to be, you know, risky on restarts, trying to do things to win this race, but also at a measured task.
Boy, great perspective, Dale. You know, it's a big weekend for Brad Keselowski and his Checkered Flag Foundation. Today, the paint scheme on the sixth car honors veterans through the Tribute to Veterans program. Over 300 military heroes are recognized on the car today. Right now, Brad K is with Kim Kuhn.
And Marty, that paint scheme looks great. And RFK also looking great recently. Both of their drivers, Brad Keselowski and Chris Buescher, solidly in the playoff picture. How do you measure, though, the success of the team knowing it's a moving target?
Yeah, I mean, it's really hard to quantify, Kim. I mean, we want to be up front. We want to win races. But, you know, that's not exactly where we're at. We're close, but not exactly where we're at. So the next step is make the playoffs, right? And we're in a good points position to do that, but we can't take that for granted. You know, six races left until the playoff starts, and we have kind of a three-car cushion, but that could disappear, you know, in the next three races. And we want to be one of those new winners. We don't want to be bounced out by one.
So Brad Keselowski and these 307 military heroes on his car looking for a win here today, Marty.
Yeah, Kim, by the way, we let our guy Steve run up to the booth here. He is gone. So it's just Kyle and I here on the Peacock pit box. And look at those names on the side of the car as well. So, Kyle, did you honestly see this level of success coming for RFK in 2023?
No, I did not. I did not. I think the car is a big factor going to this new car, this next-gen car. But I think Brad K
is the biggest factor. I think his desire, his dedication to win and building a winning organization. We know his truck team, when he owned that, was a winning organization. So for me, I expected it, but not this fast.
So Brad told me they're a solid 8th to 15th place team every week, but they need to take that next step.
Yeah.
How hard is that next step for a race team and an organization to take, Kyle?
All they got to do is sit down in a car and they can see the next step is right in front of them. And
that's
how simple it is. That's what racing's all about. You got to beat the guy in front of you. You got to keep moving forward. They are moving forward, but they're still back, as he said. 8th, 9th, 10th, 15th, right along in there. They've got to bust into that top 10 on a consistent basis, move into that top 5 on a consistent basis. Then we'll see them in victory lane, and we won't be having this conversation about RFK or Brad K anymore.
Well, coming up next, who views Pocono as their best shot to win? Kyle tells us next as we move closer to the green flag here at Pocono on a Chamber of Commerce weather day for the fans at the Tricky Triangle. If you remember the Hot Wheels we played as kids, they have become a whole lot bigger. It's an exciting new competition, Hot Wheels Ultimate Challenge, Tuesday on NBC and streaming on Peacock. Pocono Raceway, what many consider the most challenging race left in the regular season for the NASCAR Cup Series. The fans are here, and as Dale Jr. showed us a moment ago, attract the drivers' respect as well. So, Kyle, who looks at today as an opportunity for their race team?
Ty Gibbs. I said it earlier. Listen, Ty Gibbs, we talked about him starting his career here, filling in for Kurt Busch. He can be another rookie for Joe Gibbs Racing that gets his first win.
Just like Denny Hamlin?
Remember, and my next guy has an opportunity is Denny Hamlin. I think Denny Hamlin is poised. Over the last 5 or 6 weeks, we've seen him just be there. This is his track. This is his place where he starts his march towards Phoenix and trying to win that first championship. Denny Hamlin is in the perfect place to capitalize on a win here today.
Boy, he's so good at this racetrack. I'm going to go with two drivers, Kyle. Tyler Reddick first. I mean, listen, the speed has not been an issue for Tyler Reddick. That's not been a problem for the 45 team at all. It's been execution for that race team. If they can execute, they can pull off a win. And I'm going to go Alex Bowman as well. Yep. Bowman, so good at this racetrack. Blake Harris's crew chief telling me that is his best racetrack maybe. So can they execute today? He'll have two teammates up front, no doubt about it.
No doubt about that.
And can he run with those guys? He needs to show it today. Yes. By the way, did you see that traffic coming
in?
That's
crazy, man. There's traffic at Pocono.
It's awesome. And the fans are here. The grid is packed as well. So cool to see all of that here at Pocono. Time for today's pre-race ceremonies. When we come back from Pocono, great weather, great turnout as well here in the Pocono Mountains. Back at Pocono, closing in on pre-race ceremonies. KP, let's give a shout-out to the fans. I mean, that parking lot is packed.
Parking lot's packed.
Look at the grid.
Stands are packed,
well.
It's crazy.
It's so awesome, isn't it?
It's crazy up here.
We saw strategy be a massive factor in the Xfinity Series race yesterday. Will it be a factor today, Kyle?
Yes, it will be a factor. And as each strategy move is played by each separate team, there'll be multiple agendas on the racetrack. And what that brought yesterday and what it will bring today is drama. For these last 15 or 20 laps, there's going to be a ton of drama here at the end of this race.
This is where crew chiefs make all their money, right? When you're going in for a race, you're a crew chief, you go, hey, remember that Pocono race, right?
Remember that one Pocono race where I made a good call? That's it. But you're exactly right, man.
But it is everything here at Pocono. And by the way, both of the races this weekend, the winning pass, Kyle, happened with under two laps to go in the race. So you never
know
what can happen until the end and the checkered flag here at Pocono. Beautiful day. Time for some pre-race ceremonies from the Pocono Raceway.
Race fans, at this time, we ask that you please rise as you are able and remove your caps as the Ben Salem and Ligonier Valley High School Junior ROTC Color Guards present our nation's colors. Here to offer today's invocation, please welcome Motor Racing Outreach Chaplain Nick Terry.
Father, you have blessed us all with the opportunity to enjoy racing today. God, you've given us a beautiful day, and we thank you for it. We thank you for your presence with us and for our freedom. God, I pray for the men and women protecting our freedoms and ask you to keep them safe. God, I pray for safety over this race, the drivers, teams, safety workers, and officials. Lord, we honor you and ask you to be with us today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Here to perform our national anthem from the United States Air Force Band of the Northeast, please welcome Technical Sergeant Amy Aguilera, and Staff Sergeant Jonathan DeLeese.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming. And the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet
side? We'll find out where Jeff and Junior have wandered off to, plus Rick Allen and Steve Letarte, as we get the engines cranked here in Pocono for 400 miles today.
Been running fast, crossing county lines just to make my name in the city. I worked for this for all these years and I wouldn't break or back down.
And right now, it seems to be William Byron and Martin Truex Jr.'s time as they will start up front on the front row. They've won three of the last five races. They are definitely on a roll. Starting a little bit back in the seventh position in row four is Tyler Reddick, Parker.
Right, Rick, and if you just looked at the results over the last 6 weeks, you might be a little worried about Tyler Reddick in this 45 team, but those don't tell the whole story. I got to talk with Tyler this morning. He said, look, for the last 6 weeks, we have had top five, if not winning speed, but we just cannot put the races together. They broke that streak of finishing 25th or worse last week, finishing sixth, but they still had a speeding penalty on lap 73. He said that is the sort of thing we just cannot do, starting seventh here today at Pocono. He said this is an opportunity for us to put together a smooth, complete race, use that speed, and hopefully be in contention for the win, Kim.
Well, Parker, it's been no secret that the Fords have struggled with outright speed this year on intermediate tracks. So I asked Joey Logano's team where they feel like they can excel here today, knowing that. And crew chief Paul Wolf told me they consider themselves one of the top teams in terms of executing throughout the race and choosing good strategies when they matter most. Making the right call at Pocono is huge, and this team feels like that could be their ticket to win, Marty.
Well, Kim, Martin Truex Jr. has already won this week. He won on Monday, but it's hard to believe only one time in his career he's won back-to-back races, trying to do that for the second time today for Truex at one of his better racetracks. He has two wins at this track. Spent some time with James Small this morning. I said, what's been the difference this year of why everything's clicked? He said, honestly, I don't know. We've changed nothing from what we were doing last year, but certainly once you get that win, everything seems to flow much better, certainly going that way for Martin Truex Jr. right now. Let's get the engines cranked here in the Pocono Mountains.
And now, race fans, here to say the most famous words in motorsports, please welcome the High Point family.
Drivers, start your engines!
Well, here I am at the front of the grid, and who's up there? All of our championship favorites. Byron, Truex, Larson, they're winning the races. They're gobbling up the points. They're leading the laps. But check out who's in fourth.
47-year-old Kevin Harvick in his last year. He's fast this week, and let me tell you, this guy can still get it done. This kind of racetrack, every corner is different, and you got to drive them differently. This guy is up to the task. It's his job today to keep the pressure on these championship favorites and take the win from them. Now, the guy with the best seat in the house is going to check it all out, Dale Jr.
Yeah, we're up on the flag stand here, Jeff, and Robert is our honorary flag man at his very first NASCAR event. What an opportunity for him, but I'm going to give you at home the instructions that they're giving Robert. NASCAR is going to take care of all the pace laps. When we get the one to go, I'm going to push you up against the rail. I'm going to give you the green flag. You're going to wait for the cars to come out of turn three and all the way through the Geico restart zone. When they get to that zone, I'm going to tap you on the shoulder and you're going to wave that green flag, and you're waving it all the way until every car has crossed under here. You're going to remember, hey, you're on TV, so have a good time. And last of all, do not drop that flag. All right, Robert, let's go. Let's have a good time. The green flag is next.
From Long Pond, Pennsylvania, cars starting to roll off of pit road. It's NASCAR Cup Series racing from Pocono Raceway, the highpoint.com 400. One driver we have talked a lot about, not in contention for the playoffs as of yet, has been the 9 of Chase Elliott, Parker.
Right, Rick, as you mentioned, 60 points out. A lot of the discussion has been, can they point their way in with six races to go, or do they need to win? I don't know if that's really on the mind of this 9 team right now, as I spoke to Alan Gustin this morning, and he said, you know, all that's fine. We can focus on points. We can focus on places we think we can win looking ahead. But he said, really right now, as a team, we find ourselves just two steps behind. He said, for whatever reason, maybe it's the time that Chase wasn't in the car, that we didn't learn certain things. We just seem to be finding the problems, but behind everyone else. We're solving those problems too late. We've got to find a way to overcome some of those things and find some of what we missed or this season and apply it in this 9 car. If they can do that, they've shown flashes of speed, Kim, that could propel them into the playoffs.
Well, Parker, Kyle Busch won the Truck Series race yesterday at Pocono. So I asked crew chief Randall Burnett on the Cup side, what does that do for you today? He said the biggest thing is it keeps Kyle out of a bad mood. Doesn't put him in a good mood, but it keeps him out of a good mood. He said when Kyle does double duty and doesn't get the results he wants, it can affect his attitude headed into the Cup Series race. Kyle got KBM its 100th team win yesterday on the truck side, and today he is looking for his 5th career Cup Series win at Pocono. Marty?
Kimmy, think about Christopher Bell's race last weekend at New Hampshire. On the pole, looked like he had a car that could maybe contend with his teammate Martin Truex Jr. A host of problems on pit road, a wreck late in the race. Talking to Bell this week, he said, we have to eliminate that in these final 6 weeks of the regular season and start finishing races where we've run during the week. And he said, honestly, it's been my fault the last few weeks. I talked to Adam Stevens, his crew chief. He said, I don't agree with that. I think we've had problems on pit road. It hasn't been all on the driver, but he's right. We have to clean that up if we want to be legitimate contenders to make it to the championship four again this year. That has to be cleaned up in the next 6 weeks. So, Steve, how's the pole sitter feeling about today's race?
Well, Marty, let's see if we can check in with William Byron here. Hey, William, it's the guys in the NBC booth. You got a copy?
Yeah, it's the four. I got you.
All right, man. Well, mission one accomplished. You have the best seat in the house for the start. Three very tricky corners, crazy strategies. Take me through the driver mindset and the mental checklist here on the pace laps getting ready for today's race.
Yeah, really just about trying to make sure you're nice and comfortable in here. It's a long day. But, yeah, just focus on all three corners, trying to nail the balance throughout the lap and give Rudy the right inputs and give him the right advice to adjust on the car. So hopefully I can do that throughout the day and just do a good job just working traffic as well, because obviously the strategy is going to change throughout the day, so you're going to be put back in 10th or 12th at some point and you got to work your way through those cars. So we'll see how it goes.
Well, you and Rudy have just been on fire this year with 4 wins. Just how much fun is it to have a season like this?
Yeah, it's fun. We just really enjoy working together. We get along really well during the week and work through our process and show up to the racetrack prepared. So it's fun to have people around you like that, and we all gel really well. So it's a great group.
Well, we appreciate you taking the time to talk to us and the fans. Good luck. We'll be following along.
Yeah, man. Y'all have fun. It'll be exciting.
I think it's great. We're talking to the person who won the pole right before he's about to get the green flag. Let's go down to the flag stand where that's going to go with Junior.
Yeah, we're always learning something new on the flag stand this weekend. Yesterday, they only had one flag man up here for the Xfinity race. Today, these guys told me they're the A team, and there's always a backup. It's a longer race, a more critical situation, so they want to be prepared if anything were to happen, if somebody needs to go in for relief. So we got two up here today. And also these holsters right here, we had the more commonly used flags in those holsters yesterday, the green, obviously two checkered flags, the caution flag. Not today. These more experienced guys want to keep them in the bag. They don't want them blowing out of here onto the racetrack. Those cars, when they come by at speed, create quite a lot of wind, and that absolutely could happen. So always learning from these guys every time we're up here.
I love all of the different perspectives that Junior and Jeff have been able to give us this season. Different looks from pit road to even the flag stand now. Want to take a look at the starting grid today. We mentioned the front row. William Byron and Martin Truex Jr. again, the hottest two drivers. They're the top two in points right now, separated by just 17 points. That's very important. Every point matters because if they're the regular season champion, they get 15 playoff points. That's like three races that they could win.
Well, the regular season champion knows he's in the playoffs, so drivers still working their way in at the bottom in row five. Austin Cindric and Bubba Wallace, a lot of conversation about the points, where they'll be in the stages. Ty Gibbs on the outside looking in. Can he get a win? How about Corey LaJoie? Row six ties his best starting position of the season.
McDowell and Allmendinger also very good in qualifying, put up some good laps. We'll see if they can transfer that from a good lap to a good race.
Yeah, row 12, Austin Dillon, Eric Jones. This is one of the best statistic tracks for Eric Jones. Kyle Busch back in row 13. There's going to be some firepower there. Chase Briscoe, a top 10 a week ago, trying to carry the momentum. He'll start in row 15.
Surprised a little bit about Busch starting so far back, a former winner here and success. We mentioned Chase Elliott just moments ago as far as trying to get to the front. Well, they had an issue. They had to make unapproved adjustments to the car.
Yeah, so they spun out, and basically with the flat tires, drug some of the underneath components. They just wanted to repair those. Those are unapproved. He'll go to the back. These things need to be fine-tuned. I'm going to have my eyes on Bubba Wallace, right? He had a little bit of contact in qualifying. Now, all the damage that needed to be fixed was all just cosmetic, so not a big issue for Bubba. We're taking a look right there at him in that DoorDash cam, but he just... You know, that makes me nervous, right? The last time this car was on the racetrack, it made a little contact with the wall in turn one.
A little teaser, Steve, as far as I know you talked about it during the pre-race show, but strategies can be all over the place at a place like Pocono, and that's because you can pit and still not lose a lap.
55-second laps, the place is enormous. It is gigantic. We talk about three corners. It has some of the longest straightaways in NASCAR. So you could pit without going a lap down. So what's that mean? You see stage one, 30 laps. Stage two, 65. The final stage, once again, 65 laps. Well, your fuel is around 40 laps. So you can pit before the end of the stage if you're close enough to the leader, get your service under green, then just stay out and kind of leapfrog everybody. That's what we're going to say. I'm going to call it a game of leapfrog all day. The question is, are you being leapt over at the end? Are you the guy being jumped over, or are you the one doing the jumping? And to be honest, sometimes you never find out until the last 5 or 10 laps of a race.
And the other thing about that, your strategy can change based upon who's leading and what strategy they're on.
Well, listen, it's a game of chess. You're not racing yourself. You're racing 35 others. So it's going to be interesting to see how this 200-mile-an-hour game of chess turns out.
We've seen some interesting not only starts but restarts that have happened here at Pocono. We'll see how tame this one is. Again, Byron and Truex Jr. are going to lead the field to the green. Let's go back to the flag stand and Jr.
Two of our championship hopefuls bringing the field up slowly through the Geico restart zone. They tap Byron on the shoulder. Just like that, they're off and running down into turn one, 3 and 4 wide.
William Byron, the pole setter, took the outside lane. Not a surprise as the 4 of Kevin Harvick slides up a little bit, and that bright orange number 4 loses a few spots.
Yeah, lost a little traction there in turn number 1, and it shot him up the racetrack. But everybody chasing after William Byron, Martin Truex Jr., 1 and 2 as they go down Long Pond straightaway into the tunnel turn. Another long straightaway here as Byron trying to separate himself, and they're starting to get a little more single file as they work their way through 3.
Off turn 4, off turn 3, actually. Here comes Byron. We got this race underway. Here comes the cars at speed.
And I'm a little jealous. I won't lie, I'm a little jealous. That sounds awesome.
When he says at speed, we're talking speeds of over 170 miles an hour. They're flying underneath him right there.
Ty Gibbs high, be very careful. That's where he saw issues in practice, and he did scrub the wall just a little bit.
Right up against the wall in that 54 was Ty Gibbs. As we see the 48 of Alex Bowman trying to get by him. Justin Haley in the 31 right there as well. He was a part of a lot of the headlines this week coming into this race. Take another look at what happened with Ty Gibbs.
Yeah, it's just too high in the middle of the corner. Once it changes that track from that dark black to that light gray, there's dirt, there's marbles, there's less grip. He did a really nice job of not making harder contact with the wall right there. You see the right side, very handy damage. Sorry, guys, I couldn't help myself.
I know exactly what you're thinking. Man, what a perspective Junior is getting right now from the flag stand.
And you see how this track races right away, right? We talk about the three different corners. That's one thing, but they all lead to very long straightaways. So if you make a mistake, as you see right here, a big defense, I think that's Brad Keselowski in that orange number six, Corey LaJoie in the white and green seven, and then the 34, I think it is, right behind him of Michael McDowell. So now right here, the 7 has Mike McDowell inside. He has to decide if he's going to let Michael go and kind of tuck in behind him. Because if he continues to battle on the outside, which he's trying to do, he could lose momentum to the cars behind him down the front stretch.
See Ty Gibbs getting out of line, trying to stop that draft. Not let anyone get any kind of a push or pull from him, as we see Kyle Busch in the 8 right along the yellow line. They're riding along with Brez Tree, number 3 of Austin Dillon.
Now, this is great right here. All right, decision time. Are you following the 43? Well, you're definitely not following the 47 as Harrison Burton in that 21 fills the hole. So now if you're Austin Dillon, where are you going to go into the tunnel? Are you going to go to the top, go to the bottom? Watch how rough this is. Watch the back of this 43. Bang. Two bumps. That looks calm. That's anything but calm for behind the wheel.
They're going 165 miles an hour through there.
Yeah, we drove across that corner to leave the racetrack in the rental car yesterday, and you were shocked at just how rough that track was.
Yeah, what's really interesting also is how you're seeing multiple grooves. You saw that outside line get some momentum, able to make that outside work. That's something we're going to watch all day long. This has been a multiple groove racetrack in every race so far this weekend. Let's see if that continues or if it even gets wider.
Chris Buescher on the inside, making the move now on Corey LaJoie in the 7.
Has down 5 spots since the start. I know he had that very good start in the 12th position, but losing some positions early in this race.
Once again,
they're trying to get away from each other right there, guys. You see that movement way down low on the straightaways. They're trying to avoid getting side draft from the other car. They've got to run. They want to continue that momentum. You get away from the car on the outside or the inside to keep the side draft from slowing you down.
Oh, we got a spin.
Oh, the 15 goes around. Contact with the left front. That's going to bring the caution out.
So J.J. Yaley gets into the inside wall, and the first caution comes out.
We saw a lot of this in qualifying. Several cars had trouble. The track's really slick. Seems like the cars have a fair amount of grip, but when they lose a little bit of control, they just spin them out really quickly.
JJ was in the 34th position when he spun coming off turn 1.
He's pretty much around when we get to him. But this is something you see, all 4 tires are going to be flat. And he unfortunately makes big contact right there. Does some damage to the car.
Catches the front and the rear of that number 15. And so he goes around. Caution comes out. We'll have a restart. NBC Sports coverage of NASCAR on USA is brought to you by Sonic. The Sonic 299 Strawberry Shortcake Snowball Slush Float for limited time only at Sonic. And by the new movie Gran Turismo. Based on a true story, only in theaters August 11th. Crowd is bursting at the seams here, and a sellout crowd, better crowd here than the last decade of racing. So a perfect day for racing. And let's get a few updates. We'll start with Kim.
Well, currently Kyle Larson running in the fifth position. And when I talked to crew chief Cliff Daniels, he said they want to stay in the top eight throughout the day to optimize their options in terms of strategy. Right now, Kyle's saying the car's just really tight in traffic, doesn't know what it's going to do in clean air. Cliff relaying to him what the cars around him are feeling. So he has an idea of the cars battling around him and what he's going to be dealing with restarts, Parker.
Well, Kim, one of the things I think is a great indication of a driver's confidence in their race cars, how quickly they fire off at the start of a race. Well, for Bubba Wallace in that 23 car, up four positions, one of the biggest movers in the top 10, up to sixth place. And I kind of had an inkling that would be the case, and talking to him earlier today, he looked at me and said, I know I hit the wall in qualifying, that was a mistake, but we've got a really, really fast race car, and he's showing that right now, Marty.
Well, Parker, we saw Steve's breakdown in the pre-race show of the bubble, and Austin Cindric is in the must-win category. So how are they going to make that happen? Austin told me earlier today, listen, no doubt it's been a miserable season to this point, but starting this weekend and for the next 3 weeks, the two car will migrate towards Joey Logano's setup, and already it's resulted in speed here at Pocono. Started ninth, up to eighth for Austin Cindric. Could be a big weekend and a must-win scenario to make the playoffs for a second straight year. Hey, Junior, how's the view from the flag stand with a packed crowd right behind you?
Yeah, the crowd's got a lot of energy. They're thrilled about this race today and glad to be here. One of the things I'm noticing as the cars come underneath me under caution is that a lot of them aren't running. Saving fuel starts when they say, gentlemen, start your engines. It is that critical here. Every ounce of fuel will give you an advantage in this race some way, somehow, short feeling late in the race, whatever you need to do to give your crew chief opportunity, options with strategy. That's important.
We're getting ready for a restart. First caution came out early here at Pocono. It was the 15 of J.J. Yaley that went around. They'll line up two by two, and we'll see the green flag when we return. NASCAR Fantasy Live, that lets you keep tabs on your fantasy lineup throughout the race and also allow you to adjust your picks until the end of stage two. Visit NASCAR.com/fantasy, or you can select the fantasy icon on the mobile app leaderboard to make in-race changes. And this is in the infield here at Pocono, and there are a lot of wood sculptures that are made around the area here. Jeff, you really like, I think there was a bear that you saw earlier you really liked.
Oh, these guys are craftsmen. There's a guy I met named Greg. He was awesome. They beautiful little bears. It was great.
Uh-huh. By the way, I bought you one. I just want to let everybody know.
We couldn't pick it up because we misjudged the traffic, and I was a little nervous we were going to be late. But, Greg, if you're listening, we're coming back to get it.
Yeah, we appreciate it. Getting ready for the restarts. The pace car is going to make the left turn onto pit road. Field back in the hands of Byron and Truex Jr.
William Byron and Truex Jr. on the outside. The 22 of Logano lined up on the inside here for this restart. There they go, fanning out, getting runs, blocking runs. It's going to get more intense as the race goes. Those final few restarts later today will be wild.
The contact right there, guys. I saw the 34. I'm not sure what happened. Now Bubba Wallace way up the racetrack.
Yeah, McDowell in the 34. Shot down. It looked like there was some contact made as they were getting into turn one.
Now there's some two and three wide. They're going to have to get this sorted out. Three wide up front. Look at this, into the tunnel. I don't think three wide was an option, but William Byron's making it work. Okay.
All of this has allowed Logano to get clear by almost a second over Larson. Let's see if Larson now with that second position and clean air can drive him down and take the lead from the 22.
Those are those moments. We talk a lot about strategy, but it's a lot about holding serve as well. Byron had the lead. Now he's lost it.
And Logano's trying to check out on this field. As Larson about 7/10 of a second behind him. Byron a second back. Harvick a little over a second behind them. Martin Truex Jr. the top five. Bubba Wallace losing spots here as we ride along with the DoorDash on board.
He had that contact yesterday in qualifying. I wondered about this race car, whether it would still have that speed that they showed up with. Also watching through turns one and two, not sure if that outside groove has really got the grip that we saw it had yesterday. I'm sure as the cars wear the tires, they get a little more heat, that bottom is going to slicken up, and that outside might be more quicker as far as down in one and two in turns three.
And Dale, I can answer that question for you about the 23 car Bubba Wallace. He told me earlier today it just sort of scuffed the right rear bodywork, but it was no major damage in that sense. He felt like the speed was still going to be inside that race car from that wall hit they had to qualify.
Speaking of the inside, there is Bubba Wallace trying to get to the inside of the seven. You see Corey LaJoie moving up the racetrack. Now Bubba Wallace and LaJoie very close to the wall, may have even tagged it.
Yeah, it looked really slow on corner exit. It looked like he got loose in the middle, was heading up the track. I thought it was just out of the gas, but I think he did hit the wall, Rick. We'll take a look at the right side. Hard to tell its speed.
Yeah, it's way up the racetrack, gets out of the groove, makes contact right there. Has to come all the way out of the throttle, and now everybody just running him down. He's trying to figure out of his car right now. He's trying to sort it out. Is there damage? Is there not damage? He's coming to pit road.
And Corey came on the radio frantic, tire going down, tire going down. They are going to change the tire, get a drink of fuel while he's on pit road. So right sides only in fuel for Corey, who got a tire cut down.
I don't love right sides only. You're not going to lose a lap from where he pitted. I think four tires would have just been a safer call. You hope that it's a right side tire from wall contact, but if you have just a left side going slack, if that's what sent him up the racetrack, you might have to come a second time on, as we see Chase Elliott working through the field after a pit stop under that last yellow.
Trying to get by Harrison Burke in the Dex Images 21.
Battle for the lead starting to tighten up, guys. With Larson, he's been able to cut into that three-quarter second lead that Gano had. There it is, off of turn three. 3/10 separating the two cars.
Logano looks like he's running scared right now with Larson reeling him in, both running the same line through turn one. Down Long Pond straightaway. The gap was a little over 3/10 of a second. It's getting a little bit shorter now.
And their air's getting dirty for this five car. It'd be interesting to see if he has to move around to be able to close the gap even further. Can he drive up to the back bumper of this 22 car right in his tracks? It'll be a tough move to make. It's a hard track to make those kind of passes on. You see down here in the corner, he follows him into the bottom. The 22 up the racetrack actually helps the five put a little air on that nose.
And Kyle Larson with the Xfinity fastest lap. Larson, though, after that restart, the team came on the radio and said, you just need to chip away at Logano. He is running very loose. You don't have to get him in a lap. You don't have to get him in two. Be patient and just slowly and methodically run him down. That is exactly what you're seeing Kyle Larson taking great direction from his team.
Spotting for Kyle Larson, Tyler Mahon. Cliff Daniels giving direction from on top of the pit box. And the gap now getting a little bit wider between Logano and Larson. Up there for the lead, William Byron has settled into third now after the restart. Harvick and Mark Trex Jr. in the top five. Marty.
Rick, it's interesting. William Byron started on this restart on the front row leading and was a control car, and he came on the radio after losing the lead first to Logano and then his teammate Kyle Larson and said felt like the car was so loose he had a right rear going down. Obviously it's fine, but how important is that launch here, Jeff, on restarts, and how hard is it to get the momentum back after you've lost it?
We're going to see all day, Marty, that restarts are huge, and it all starts in the restart zone. You've got to get a great launch, great forward momentum, because that carries you into turn one, progressing on the car in front of you, keeping the car from behind you, gaining on you. If you don't get a great launch, now you're on defense entering turn one. It is a huge part of having success at this racetrack.
Well, I'm having a lot of fun on the flag stand here. It's a lot of fun watching this race, but also the fans up there in the stands. My home is in the booth, and that's where I'm headed next.
The new movie, Gran Turismo, based on a true story, only in theaters August 11th, but you can get your tickets. They are on sale now. All smiles for the fans here. And I'm sure a lot of them are Joey Logano fans, as he is out front by 3/10 of a second over Kyle Larson. William Byron running in that third spot. Harvick is fourth. Martin Truex Jr. is fifth. Then it's Bell, Hamlin, Blaney, Reddick, Allmendinger, all in the top 10. And it seems as though, Steve, we're seeing Kyle Larson close the gap, and he gets within about two and a half car lengths, and then he can't close it any further.
Well, what makes passing Joey Logano very tough is he's just a driver that makes very few mistakes. So you can see he just kind of content in running his line. He's a groove up in three, also groove up in one, Jeff. And I think as long as he doesn't miss a corner, he's going to force Kyle Larson to find an alternate path.
I think you mentioned a groove up, and I think that's actually the fastest lane. So, yes, Larson has clean air underneath him, but Logano is able to keep his momentum up running in this second lane. So it's going to be a very tough pass for Larson. And something else I've noticed, guys, we had three Fords in the top eight. And this is something that we started to see the last few weeks. The Fords have struggled early in the year, but they're starting to show some speed, starting to show the ability to lead laps, run up front at the time of the year that it's most important.
You mentioned speed. Let's get a few updates from maybe one of the best on this racetrack. Denny Hamlin currently in the seventh spot, Parker.
Right, Rick. And sometimes race cars just get better with some laps on them. That might be the case for Denny Hamlin and that 11 car as he works on his teammate Christopher Bell there through turn three. At the start of the race, he came on the radio and said, whoa, he got had a huge moment off of turn one, got very loose, then said his feedback to Chris Gabart was that car was very, very loose. But for the last couple of laps, he has been the fastest car on the racetrack as it starts to come to him here and tries to make that pass, Marty.
For Parker, Ryan Blaney was so excited to get to Pocono after having a terrific car, maybe a winning car at New Hampshire last week, or at least could compete with Martin Truex Jr., and then a bad pit stop on the final pit stop of the day. What's going on with the handling of the 12 car? Listen in.
A little bit of time here, I'll be a little better. I'd say three is my weakest corner. Tight initial turn of the wheel in there.
And he also said the bumps are just so rough as we ride on board with the Advanced Auto Parts onboard camera. His secret weapon today might be the young man on the bottom left of your screen. We've talked about how strategy will be everything today. Jonathan Hassler, one of the best young crew chiefs when it comes to strategy, and that early caution certainly going to add to the playbook today, Kim.
Well, Ty Gibbs currently running in the 14th position. And remember, this race last year is when Ty made his Cup Series debut, filling in for an injured Kurt Busch. But when I came on the holler this morning and talked to crew chief Chris Gayle, I said, nice qualifying effort. They started in the 11th position. He said, no, we want to be where our teammates are. They qualified second, fifth, and eighth. They said, even though Ty is a rookie, we hold him to a higher standard because we know his potential. Currently, Ty complaining he just needs the most help in turn three.
Great job, guys. All right, Steve, we've got Logano up front with Larson running second. So will the top 10, are they running a strategy of all the way to the end of this stage, and maybe somebody outside the top 10 starts looking at maybe changing that strategy up?
Well, the choice for Joe Logano right now with six laps to go on the stage is he's currently leading. So there you see right there Chase Elliott moving up. That'll be for the 21st position for Ricky Stenhouse Jr. You know, if Logano stays on the racetrack and wins the stage, that's a playoff point. I think everybody wants that. But if you don't think you can win a playoff point, you could pit with three to go before pit road closes, not lose a lap, and kind of cycle to the front. Now, that option is really only for any driver that's within about 15 seconds of the lead. You get farther behind than that, you will lose a lap. So it'll be decision time for both Logano and Larson. For Larson is really tough because he's so close, Jeff. He might think, I could pass the 22 and win this stage.
Yeah, that's a tough call, and that's where I would not want to be a crew chief. As a driver, I just have to focus on my job, trust my crew chief to make the right call here, go try to put as much pressure on Logano as I can to try to win this stage, but I just got to trust my crew chief. He sees a bigger picture.
The gap, once again, has accordioned out to about a half of a second between one and two. It's been as tight as about 0.2 seconds.
What's going to make this even tougher for these drivers and crew chiefs is that the speed of these Goodyear tires really isn't dropping off. I mean, cars continue to run some of their fastest laps of the day. Between burning the fuel off and the car getting lighter, and if they find a little bit of clean air or at least a gap to the car in front of them, that extra downforce, you see a lap time kind of pop up. This is a lot about strategy and a lot about driving ability in these three corners, but let's not overshadow the pit stops. You know, not only do you need the speed, which William Byron, Larson Chastain kind of chopped that list, topped that list for the season, but this is not a day to go 10 tenths on pit road. And what I mean by that is this is a 90% day. As you see a car turn left to come to pit road, I believe the aid of Kyle Busch was getting a little concerned about that 15-second gap to the leader, Kim.
Yeah, and so they took the opportunity to play a little strategy card here. Kyle just saying the car was loose. That's the same thing they were battling in practice yesterday. You see the right side tires go on. It's going to be a four-tire stop for Kyle Busch under green.
So does this start a flow of more cars making their way? It looks like they're having a problem on the right side or the left side.
So this is the fear of every crew chief. So we're going to see where the eight blends back out to the leader. Now we're going to have a little bit to cover because we're also going to have a wave of pit stops coming in right here. So this is Kyle Busch leaving. Let's see what Joey Logano tries to do off turn four. He's going to kind of stay on the racetrack. There you go. Look, everyone else. Here comes Larson, Byron, Harvick. This is going to look like a caution. There's so many cars. But what about Kyle Busch? Ooh, he is going to get lucky and stay on a lead lap, even with that slow pit stop, Kim.
And Kyle Larson complaining again, just a little bit tight in traffic. They told me they were going to do something from the leader if they didn't have the lead. You see the four fresh Goodyear tires going on. Sunoco Fuel, here's the four of Kevin Harvick finishing up his stop. Kevin, just again, tight in traffic. Marty.
Boy, Kim, look at all those cars coming down pit road. William Byron, you saw, has the number one pit crew. He also has the number one stall today. Said the car just got way too tight when he was behind others. Ryan Blaney coming to pit road saying, too, the top car was getting tighter the longer he ran. And look at all the traffic coming off pit road. We'll see where they blend, but some staying out to get those stage points to be handed out here in three laps.
Staying out because of stage points is staying out because of their gap to the leader. We see all these cars leaving pit road right here, well in front of the leader. Joey Logano, there's Joey Logano, the red car. I'm still looking for that Penske yellow. Starting to get used to this Verizon red for the 22.
Yeah, we've got some guys that are racing for that last spot in the playoff points. We've got Allmendinger, McDowell, Wallace, all those guys, they've stayed out. And so they're trying to just get as many points as they can, doing all they can to get themselves into the playoffs.
One other driver that's looking for as many points as he can get would be Martin Truex Jr. And that's because he right now is in a big fight with the 24 of William Byron for potentially the regular season championship. If you do that, you get 15 playoff points. That's like winning three races.
You see right there the 9 to Chase Elliott, the 8 of Kyle Busch. Well, look at this. Joey Logano, who's that right behind Joey Logano? I think that's the 47 of Stenhouse, who said, man, I came to pit road and I lost a lap. Now he's using those new tires. He has to push hard, and probably Logano thinks, man, I got a big gap behind me. I don't want to mess with this 47. Keeping him a lap down isn't a high priority for me. So that's an important move by Stenhouse Jr. to get back on the lead lap. That could make his entire day.
It also shows that new tires may matter. You know, we didn't see that in practice, Steve, but with Stenhouse being able to go up there and pass the leader, that shows me that new tires could come into play late in this race.
47 was 16 seconds back, so that's why he came out just a little bit behind Logano, but was able to get back on the lead lap. That puts 35 cars on the lead lap at the end of stage one, as Joey Logano, with a 1.8-second lead over Martin Truex Jr., is going to win stage one. Already his third stage win of the year. Martin Truex Jr. grabbing those stage points. Denny Hamlin, Tyler Reddick, A.J. Allmendinger.
They're
the top five.
Going down,
he got real late there. Oh, sounds like a potential tire going down to the 22. Might have got super lucky.
Stage one over with some rough racing for JJ Yaley. He spun around early, but in the end, the crowd here got a great shot of Joey Logano winning his stage. Verizon Frontline is the advanced network for first responders. Today, Verizon honored the members of the Pennsylvania State Police, the Pocono Mountain Regional Police, and EMS, Pocono Raceway Fire Rescue, Tuckanuck Township Fire Company, the Lehigh Valley Health Network, and more. Please join Verizon in thanking first responders for all they do for us every day. And now the cars making the way onto pit road, led by that 22 of Logano, Kim.
And he said he was loose into all of the corners. He rotated good and won loose over the bumps. You see him top left. He said, I was tight in traffic before I got clean air, though, so do not tighten it up. They did make a small air pressure adjustment on those Goodyear tires to give more grip, Parker.
And for Tyler Reddick at the top right of your screen, he was just very on edge through turn three. The team said, we can see that. We'll make a small adjustment for him. That's four Goodyear tires, Sunoco Fuel. The bottom left of your screen, Denny Hamlin. We noted how loose he was. They're going to make an adjustment on that, and they're going to wait on fuel just a second, Marty.
Big debate on Martin Truex Jr.'s radio as to whether to pit here or not. Waiting a little bit on fuel, just like a teammate, Denny Hamlin. They did decide to come to pit road for fresh Goodyear tires. He said it was crazy in traffic. The car was so tight. But when everybody else pitted, the car went way free. Dramatic, the difference in handling when all those cars pitted.
The cars that came to pit road, Hamlin fastest off. He gains a couple spots. Martin Truex Jr. held on to that second spot. And Reddick also gained one. Take your taste buds somewhere cool with the new Sonic 299 Strawberry Shortcake Snowball Slush Float, topped with ice cream and crunchy sugar crystals. For a limited time only at Sonic. Sonic. Take a look at the points earned in stage one. Again, big for Martin Truex Jr., gaining the 9 points because he's in a tight battle right now with William Byron for the regular season championship. Again, Logano wins a playoff point because he won the stage. Then you look at Allmendinger, McDowell, Wallace, all right there at that cutoff line for the playoffs, and they're fighting for every point they can get.
And the car that's also in that battle with them, Suarez, finishing 12th in that stage, does not get any points. So that these are the little things that are happening throughout all of the races leading up to the playoffs that decide that bubble battle. These cars unlikely to get a win before we get to the playoffs. Possible, but unlikely. These stage points is what's going to matter.
Every point matters. Okay, KP, I know you're down there on the Peacock pit box, but let's talk a little bit about starts, restarts. What can you do to maximize your position and maybe gain positions on these restarts?
Well, listen, when they get five wide, you're not going forward anywhere. We've seen that on the starts. But if you look at the start of the race, we talked about it earlier in pre-race, Steve and I. The start of the race is the calmest time. You see this start. You see a couple of guys at the back peek out to the left a little bit or peek out to the right on your screen, but nobody really plans out. Let's go to the first restart that we have. This is a they're already halfway through the pack. They're 3 and 4 wide. We see some radical moves right here. And when we get down here, it's 3 and 4 wide again. This is only the first restart of the race. I understand why Junior left the flag stand and came back to the safety of the booth, because it's only going to get wilder.
He wasn't wearing a helmet.
Well, so you see Hendrick cars of the 5 and the 24 up front because they pitted before the stage ends. Why does that work? Well, now look, they've came to the front of the pack. Harvick, Bell, Blaney, all at lap 27. So look way down here in 14th. What is this? Hamlin, Truex, Reddick, Logano. They were the winners, or the like the top four at the end of the stage. Now look where they're going to restart. They're, what, row 6, row 7? And you see 27 to 32, only a couple of those are green flags. So the cars in front of them have like 2 hard laps on their tires. I don't even think that's a tire disadvantage this weekend. So going to be a stressful time for Hamlin, Truex, and those fast cars. Parker.
And there might be more stress for Denny Hamlin. He was told to wait on the nod of the fuel. Remember, fuel strategy is so important. Take a look at this pit stop. He's going to go before the nod from the fueler saying it's full. Gabe Hart came on the radio and said, we might be close on this one. You need that fuel, Steve, to make these strategies work.
Small details, small execution.
And this is a familiar sight. William Byron on the inside, Larson on the outside, or vice versa, as we see the 24 and 5. Getting the green flag, and once again, as Kyle Petty mentioned, they're fanning out 3, 4, 5 wide as they get ready to come in and turn. One contact made.
22 of Logano's
around. Logano, who won the stage,
the
backwards.
Suarez in the wall.
That is huge for Suarez. Talked about this tight point battle. This is the problem with starting back mid-pack. Joey Logano won stage one. Remember, think about this. Only one stage one winner has finished in the top 5, 2 of the last 8 races. 2 of the last 8 races, stage one winner. So that's the danger in getting those points and then getting mid-pack.
Look at all the damage to the front of Suarez's 99 machine.
And think about all of the adjustments and changes to these cars that NASCAR made to allow them to absorb these hits, and this is the ramifications from that. Obviously, it absorbs a lot of energy that the driver does not, but the damage much more severe in these impacts and these wrecks than we've seen in the past.
Yeah, and I'm great with it. Right, I'd much rather have the car as safe as possible. You know, people hate this cliche, but you don't build them to wreck and keep racing. Like, when you wreck, you wreck. I hate it for Suarez. The 22, on the other hand, it didn't look like his was damaged too much. It looks like he's just stuck with four flat tires. We asked NASCAR
four
this morning.
Four flats.
Need
tires or tow truck quick.
Okay, so what they're going to do is push him around to his pit stop, let him put tires on it. They're not going to remove him from the race with the damaged vehicle policy and all that. The AMR safety team there is on track to help him, but he's definitely going to lose a lap or two.
We'll see what happens to start all this. Here's Joey Logano in the outside lane. Goes to the bottom. Oh, yeah, a little bit of contact from the car in front of him. He came down on him. Couldn't quite make out who that was.
So there it is. The 45 of Reddick is on the outside of the 22, and the 22 is getting shoved around. Like, you know, he has some control, but when you're getting pushed that much, Jeff, you kind of are being steered by the car behind you, and you see it steer him into the left rear quarter panel of the 45 car, Reddick. It turns him around.
Drivers, I always want to know, like, when you go down the interstate, you have these blind spots, but that's with side mirrors. These guys, how well-defined is, like, lane 1, 2, and 3, Jeff?
Not very well, but let's watch Suarez. Let's see what he is. The bottom car, oh, there's the contact right there. He just was underneath some other cars. They came down on him. Just nothing he could do.
One of those is Bubba Wallace. We're going to ride on board with him. Look at this right, the left side of your screen. He hits the right rear quarter panel. He's drove down into the right rear quarter panel by another car.
And that car was Michael McDowell. So you wonder if he's got damage. Again, another one of the guys in the points trying to make the playoffs. And Suarez's car, it's a lot of damage. You mentioned Logano maybe not having as much damage. He will go multiple laps down, though, trying to get him to pit road. And on top of that, getting the car back to pit road damages all the underbody.
Right.
And the car many times does not perform as well after that.
Yeah, so, I'll be surprised if the car drives as good as it's drove all day long after dragging all that stuff off. I mean, just even a thousandth of an inch can make a big difference in how much that, you know, that car loses in downforce. But carrying it this way is a little unique, kind of a new way of doing things to get these cars back.
It's better this way because you're not damaging the rear diffuser. That's the most sensitive part of this car.
If there's anything that you can say is better for Joey Logano, he's got to hang his hat on that. Hey fans, NASCAR and the Premier Partners want to thank you. Visit NASCAR.com/thankyoufans to learn how you can win an exclusive Diamond experience just for being a fan. See some interesting setups there in the infield and enjoying a great event here at Pocono.
You know, Rick, we talk about the smallest things making the difference in a season, and every point matters, Jeff, right? We talk about that. Well, so does a practice of qualifying. You look at the 99 of Daniel Suarez. He qualified 17th. So why does that matter, right? Well, he came in 1 point below. He qualified 17th, about 0.4 of a second behind, say, Ty Gibbs in 11th. What that did is put him in a position where he was too far behind the leader to end that stage to come under green and get track position. Travis Mack had to stay out. He stayed out. He wasn't far enough up to get stage points. So now he's back in the middle of the mess, and he gets caught up in this accident. And now he has all this damage. It all starts. Everything matters, Jeff. You say it time and time again, right? A better qualifying lap for the 99 could have been the difference maker. Now the 22... I don't know what to say. I like the call of staying out and winning the stage. I think you take a playoff point whenever you can, Jeff. And now, I mean, it's just a tore up race car. It's just bad. That's racing, I guess, is what you would call that.
Yeah, you know, when this happened, it spun around and it hit the left side car, the car pretty hard on the wall as well. So the damage to that, and Kim also the damage done getting the car back to pit road.
Yeah, and this is really a tale of two tapes because on Daniel Suarez's side of things, no stage points. So this amplifies the fact that they got no points. good news for Joey Logano, despite the accident, despite the damage to the car, they won that stage. So showing the importance of stage points if you get caught up in an accident later. Damage repair is done, it looks like, on the 99. They might bring him back around one more time. Travis Mack asked a number of times, Daniel, what your gauges look like. He said the water and the oil look good. They did full crash repair on that 99 of Daniel Suarez, Parker.
And Kim, two other cars that had some contact in that incident there that are on the playoff bubble were Michael McDowell in the 34 and Bubba Wallace in the 23. Both teams were evaluating those cars and both came to the conclusion that they're okay. Even the 34 that has a little scuff on the left front and the 23 had a little scuff on the right front, but both teams establishing that they are all right. And the spotters on those teams also reminding their drivers, we see those fanning out into turn one, that they can't see very well. It's a blob of cars. They can't tell you sort of the definition of how you're side by side. So reminding those drivers, they're kind of on their own into turn one.
Steve, I want to make sure we remind the fans the damaged vehicle policy of the two cars that have come, that were in this incident, that have come to pit road. They're on a clock.
Yeah, they have 7 minutes basically to repair their car, and they'll drag your car back there to let you work on it. The damaged vehicle policy is not to eliminate cars that should stay in the race. The cars that really shouldn't, we don't want to see 15 cars out there riding around wrecked in the car's way, and that's what this team's trying to do, is take all that time and evaluate what's going on with the 22. Now, the interesting thing for the field itself is as we ride around here under yellow, we are moving very dangerously close to a pit window, as you see the 99 of Suarez. So pit road was open at some point, and there were no takers. Now they're closed again. I just wonder if they reopen at any point. No, they're going to leave them closed because the 99 or the 22 sitting on pit road. So I was a little surprised more teams didn't come, kind of top off with fuel and get on strategy towards the end of the pack.
It's a long ways around this racetrack as we're seeing one car, a couple cars make their way onto pit road, but so much damage to the 99.
Yeah, I'm surprised it's actually still functioning and he doesn't have any issues as far as water pressure and other things like that. We, you know, this is unique to the next-gen car. We're seeing damage to the nose of these cars that we are usually not seeing. So I think this is an experience, a new experience for the team as well, to try to repair this car and get it back into the race.
And I think also this team may be just looking at the 22 team. If we can go out and make a lap, then we've run a lap more than the 22 and we finish in front of him. So it could be just simply a move for that. I don't know that they're ever going to have enough speed in that 99 to get it going, but pick up a spot on Joey Logano, every point matters. Kim.
And despite Daniel telling Travis on the radio, my gauges look good, Travis said, it is a mess down here. You are leaking fluids. Take it to the garage. So that gauge not showing Daniel what was actually being diagnosed on the car, because when he left that pit stall, again, just a mess in Daniel Suarez's pit.
All right, so back to the damaged vehicle. You have time, but what you're not allowed to do is go behind the wall. Now, listen, if you come out, you hit minimum speed, you could go back there, fix anything you want. You're not on the clock. But when you're on the clock, if you go to the garage, your day's done. So Daniel Suarez will be basically the last car in today's race, first car out.
Well, you had mentioned make a lap. He did make a lap. Remember, he went around.
Yeah, but you have to run at minimum speed.
He has one more lap than Joey Logano because it was under caution. So he actually, okay, if Joey Logano doesn't get a go, he's going to score in front of him.
Yeah, that's the only reason he made that lap. Yeah. They knew they were done. They just made a lap trying to beat the 22.
And so we see the DVP, that clock, and the drivers now coming out of turn three as we're getting ready to go back to green. William Byron, he's on the outside. Larson on the inside. We'll try it again.
Great pushes from both lanes. That outside looks a little more organized. Got three cars bumper to bumper.
They're side by side into one. Larson tried to surge ahead, got about a half a car length there, and then momentum, and now Austin Dillon slides around.
That all started in turn one on a restart. On the restart, BJ McLeod had some trouble getting down into one. Kyle Petty talked about it, how crazy these restarts are, how aggressive you have to be. Here, Austin trying to get the car fired up, won't fire.
AMR safety crew to him.
Cycle the ECU if you need to. Cycle the ECU.
Got it fired back up. We'll see if he's able to roll back to pit road.
not uncommon for a car to spin and take a while to fire it off. I don't understand why, but it just happens for whatever reason. Let's see what happens. Way in the back. See the orange car in the back. BJ is on the bottom, blocking a little bit. Here he comes up the racetrack into the left rear quarter panel of Austin Dillon.
Dillon was running 26th, so back in the pack. That means another restart. And
first, it means pit road, because I think we are in a real decision maker. Let's ride on board right here. Oh, man, that's frustrating. Didn't really do anything wrong.
Great job by him, though, standing in the throttle and then lifting off the throttle at the right time to make sure it didn't get turned left and go down to the inside.
So as the field comes around, Rick, lap 43 of 160, so 118 laps to go in the race. We think you can go 40 laps on fuel. You know, this might put him in a situation where they feel good about their fuel window, and this is the struggle of this race, right? It's an easier decision for the cars in the back, right? I mean, if you're, say, 20th or farther back, you're always swinging for the fences, trying a new strategy. But, man, if you're Byron and Larson, you're seeing all this chaos, you're like, well, I don't want to go back there. It's so nice up here at the front.
We saw Joey Logano coming off pit road to rejoin the field, and you could tell that car just not quite right. There's some damage to the left side from hitting the wall. I think he's got a toe link bent or broken on that left rear that they'll have to either repair. Maybe he's just out here just like Suarez was to make laps. Caution's out, go out there, ride around till this caution's over with, and we're coming to pit road, and we're probably going to exceed the damage clock trying to make that repair to the left rear suspension, but they gained that position on Suarez.
Yeah, he's just a couple seconds away from that clock expiring, so I think what you just explained is what they're trying to do is potentially get in front of Suarez for that finishing position. So we knew restarts were going to be tricky. Well, it's happening all over this field. Austin Dillon, the latest victim. The Premier League returns August 11th on NBC USA and Peacock. The world's best players return to the pitch with new dreams, new stakes, and the new hope of a brand new season. Also, don't miss the PL Summer Series all week on the networks of NBC USA and Peacock. You're watching the HighPoint.com 400 from Pocono Raceway. And people are watching from everywhere, the infield, the grandstands.
These restarts have been crazy.
That is an understatement. Marty.
Rick, we talked about how strategy is really all over the map here at Pocono. So this is an interesting twisty with all of these cautions that have come out. Those who pitted and went all the way to the end of stage one now feel like they can connect that to lap 80 or so and make it two more stops in this race like Martin Truex Jr. But there's a ton of cars, Steve, that pitted short of stage one, did not run it all the way to the end. Those cars say they cannot make it all the way to lap 80. They're going to need at least one more caution in this stage to be able to pull that off. Man, it's down to a game of inches here on pit road and for all these strategists and crew chiefs.
That tells me they're all getting better mileage than I expected. I thought we'd see a lot of cars pit there to fuel, but what Marty just said is, you know, they're going to get well over 40 laps of this tank of gas between the yellows and a little bit better mileage.
We'll try again. That outside row has the 24, the 4, and the 12 all lined up, as well as the 6. Back up through the gears they go. We'll see how they do through turn one this time. Now, cars jumping out of line.
Chase Elliott makes a move on his teammate Alex Bowman down into turn one.
Oh, and around goes a 5. Larson goes up and tags the wall. Caution comes out again.
Marty told us a while ago that a request came to William Byron, from William Byron to his spotter. Make sure I get my tires cleaned up on the restart. They did not have good grip driving into turn one with debris on them. Get them cleaned up. That's something that we've always had trouble with, and you wonder that that's what happened here. Kyle Larson on the front row.
He's getting a push from Christopher Bell right there behind him. Man, I think Christopher shoved him a little bit too far into the corner, and he was worried about hitting his teammate, or maybe they did make contact. But Christopher Bell had the five-car upset right there.
Yeah.
Way too much pushing too late down into the transition of turn one.
Having your tires clean is really important, but having them all on the ground is more important.
Well, how about Ryan Blaney and Kevin Harvick splitting them? Kevin Harvick, that orange car, gets around on the outside. Blaney gets on the brakes and goes to the left. Oh, man. I just can't believe nobody made contact. I was seeing how hard he hit the wall. It looked pretty square. I'm going to use the word soft from damage. Take a look at this.
Riding along with Blaney.
That's just a great view. You can hear him on the brakes, off the gas.
And what?
The millisecond that he said, all right, I got to stand in the gas because he's going to get out of my way. He did it to miss the wreck. But Kim.
And checking the rear right now of that car. They think he hit pretty square. Aren't overly concerned about damage, but want to do their due diligence. As you see, go, go, go. They feel like it looks good. Changed four tires on that. Maybe they're going to check the front too. Cliff Daniels saying make sure he has all the front clearance he needs to check the splitter. So they're doing that right now. Listen to the radio, though, that came from Kyle Larson. All right, not hearing that radio, but they did come on the radio and confirm to Kyle, you did nothing wrong. The 22 got aggressive and got into the back of you, Marty.
Yeah, Christopher Bell felt so bad about that. He came on the radio to Adam Stevens, says, man, that was my fault. I did not mean to push him that hard into turn one. And Adam Stevens said, hey, bud, listen, it's early in stage two. There's a long way to go in this race. And remember, we've been on the receiving end of that. It happens.
Interesting what we saw from the 12 car. He is, you know, he's pushing the car in front of him, Blaney, and he starts to lift and roll out of the gas early to allow the car in front of him to get down into the corner. Kevin Harvick coming on the pit road, changing up his strategy a little bit, just about to miss his pit box, Kim.
And you see that crew kind of fumbled there too as he almost missed that pit box, had to kind of adjust there. Right side tires going on. It's going to be four tires. Sunoco fuel. Kevin Harvick will typically always take four. It gives him the feeling that he is on offense versus defense. All right, and back here at the care center, Daniel Suarez has been released. Daniel, what happened?
I don't know. I got thrown around on the right rear in a very fast straightaway. So just lucky that actually we didn't get wrecked big time. Unfortunately, you know, we can't continue anymore. But at the end of the day, you know, it's our fault. We shouldn't be back there with those guys, with the squirrels. You know, we missed the balance of the car in the first stage, and we lost a bunch of track position, and we sort of kind of got it back a little bit. I felt like, you know, once we got the balance, we're going to be able to drive to the front, but I didn't get an opportunity and got wrecked before that. But again, I mean, a racing incident, but we shouldn't be back there racing with those guys anyway.
What does this mean for the next 5 weeks in this team?
I mean, we just have to control what we can control. Unfortunately, on this one, it wasn't my mistake. It was a racing incident. The crazy thing is that the 34 and the 23 are the ones that actually wrecked me. I mean, they didn't mean it, but it's funny that those are the guys that I'm racing for the points. But it's what it is. We have to just continue to work and go to Richmond and focus for that one.
Well, unfortunate for Daniel Suarez. You could tell there, not happy about the way it ended up, but not pointing too much fingers at blame. It was the five around that brought out this caution. Five already. NBC Sports coverage of NASCAR on USA is brought to you by Progressive. Save when you bundle auto, home, or motorcycle insurance. Visit progressive.com. Credit One Bank, a credit card company, and by Toyota. Let's go places. We just heard from Daniel Suarez. He knows that
bubble, that line right there of getting into the playoffs is very, very intense right now. KP, what are you thinking about with the bubble as we look at this and this incident and the restarts?
Listen, Steve Letarte explained it well in pre-race, but all I wanted to talk about were the guys at the top of the list. But the bubble, the intensity has picked up. Those three guys, Michael McDowell, Bubba Wallace, and Daniel Suarez, were all in that incident. So they all banged off of each other. Daniel Suarez got the worst of the end, or the worst of the deal. It is going to only get more intense. Points are getting scarce. Opportunities are getting rare to make them up.
Yeah, there will only be five races remaining after this Pocono race. So you're trying to get everything you can get. Bubba Wallace, as you mentioned, involved in it, but he's 22 points above the cut line. McDowell 15 right now above Allmendinger. 16 drivers will make the playoffs.
If you can believe it, Rick, we've run 19 laps of this stage. Majority under yellow. We can't seem to get the race through turn one.
Yeah, 46 laps still to go. It'll be 45 when they come back around for stage two. That's just a reminder, if you are playing fantasy, you have 45 laps to figure out if you want to take your garage driver out and put him in their lineup.
Well, how well is Larson going to recover, Rick? Because that's basically what I'm hinging on.
I've already put him in the garage just in case.
In case you forget?
Yeah, well, in case I forget.
And what about Kevin Harvick? Kevin Harvick was running second, and he pitted, and now he is all the way back in 29th.
And that's where we've seen incidents on restarts.
He has tons of laps, more fuel than other people, but he gave up a ton of track position.
We'll see how he does back here in the chaos. Byron and now Bell making up the front row. Bell on the inside, Byron on the outside, and back up through the gears they go.
Great organization in the outside, and you see there that line surging ahead. Now this organized on the inside with another three-wide move by Chase Elliott.
Chase Elliott, the man on the move, in the number nine on the inside of that second duo of cars. Alex Bowman in the Ally 48, taking a peek to the inside of his teammate. Bubba Wallace trying not to move up a little bit too high into the six of Brian Keselowski as those two continue to fight for a spot. Bell, after starting on the front row, has now dropped all the way back, and Keselowski's going to get the spot from him. And so Bell back to fifth. Byron, Blaney, Gibbs, Keselowski, and Bell.
Truex moved in behind Chase there, now to the inside of the nine car.
Tyler Reddick going by Bubba Wallace down Long Pond straightaway as they head towards the tunnel turn.
Bowman fading just a little bit to the back, lost a spot to Truex. Another one right here to Denny. Side by side behind him. That sorts out with Reddick and teammate Bubba Wallace getting through. Kyle Busch fighting to the outside of the two car now. Cindric. Kyle in that eight car on the outside, exiting turn three.
Now this outside lane, you talked about it being organized. It's even organized into this run. That two car, Cindric, stuck on the bottom. No momentum down on the bottom lane. Outside line just going by him.
Haley in the 31 on the outside of Cindric. Again, the story this past week was Haley is going to be moving to Rick Ware Racing in 2024, leaving College Racing. There's an opening now at College Racing. Turn three here at Pocono.
Kyle Busch battling right now. Looks like battling with Bubba Wallace.
Bubba's lost the position to Bo.
Long sweeping turn three here at Pocono.
Kyle Busch battling right now. Looks like battling with Bubba Wallace. Bubba's lost the position to Bowman.
Kyle Busch has really good run going right here. Had good speed in practice, and I talked to him before the race, and he said that when they went to qualifying film, it was just horrible, qualified poorly. You see that move right there, didn't work out for him. Now Busher looking underneath him. Kyle's gonna use that outside lane, get back by Busher. But Kyle was excited about his car today. Disappointed to qualify, but thought they could race really well.
And again, Kyle Busch running in the 12th spot right now. Bubba Wallace just in front of him. William Byron has a half a second lead over Blaney.
Way down low, there's the 34 McDowell trying to get around both. Ricky Stenhouse and Cindric, and here comes, looks like maybe the 14 car, the 41 car, Priest. Into the picture. All these guys here racing around the backside of the top 20.
Cindric going the wrong way. He's had really good speed early in this race, but just having trouble getting his car to drive the way he wants it to.
How frustrating does that have to be for Austin Cindric when his teammate Blaney is running up there second? We saw Logano win stage one.
Look at him. Giving hand signals to each other, not happy about how they're racing each other, but that's the way it is. If this is this area. Oh, contact right there. Was that maybe, you know, the number one signal that he gave him, and maybe Stenhouse didn't like that. He said, man, you know what? I'm going to give you one in the door for that. More contact right here, and look what's happening. Eric Almirola, yeah, the three of Austin Dillon's like, what do I do here? You guys need to sort this out.
Austin Dillon looking to the inside of that 47 of Ricky Stenhouse Jr. It's Noah Gregson in the 42 just in front of them.
Yeah, I wonder if Cindric flipped off the 47. The 47 drove in his door in turn three. Unhappy about that. Man, that, you know, that can really frustrate you when you see a driver do that.
You see on the bottom left, the 22 out of the race. Couldn't meet minimum speed with that damage, so he'll retire for the rest of the event.
Larson struggling off the tunnel there for some reason. Lost a spot to Eric Jones. Now he's going to turn and go back underneath the 43 if he can. Can't do it. Off of turn three here. Harvick behind this.
Look how hard it is to pass. Larson up only up to 25th. It's tough. I mean, it's very hard to get position on somebody to complete the pass here.
Riding along with the Hunt Brothers Pizza on board of Harvick. Remember, he came to pit road. That has relegated him back into the 26th position. Larson also back there running with him.
Let's see right here. He just waves like, hey, what's going on? Throwing his hand up in there like, what are you doing? And then this 47 just racing hard. I think it's loose. I wanted it to be the other way around. But
I like the other story. Yeah, I like it was more entertaining for sure. I was with you.
Yeah. McDowell right there around the 8 car. Kyle Busch back to 16th here.
Four-time winner at
way
Pocono.
Up the track. Way up the track. Oh, almost contact with the wall.
Uncharacteristic. The mistakes that we've seen out of Kyle Busch. We saw it a week ago at New Hampshire. Practice qualifying and then in the race he had issues. Now here at Pocono, missing the line.
He's just pushing really hard. He always drives hard, aggressive driver. We all know that. Just overstepping his bounds a little bit the last couple weeks. Maybe sending a signal to his team. Hey, man, I got to be able to have better cars. I need to be able to drive the cars this hard, Kim.
And when I talked with crew chief Randall Burnett this morning, I said, what's your focus over these next six races? He said, we need to do more work to get playoff ready. And for us, that means we have too many peaks and valleys throughout the course of the race. We need to be more level, specifically through the green flag, to the checkered flag. So this is another incident where they're having to deal with a valley, and they're looking to just have a consistent race, Marty.
Well, Kim, hand signals aside, Austin Cindric fighting for everything he can on the racetrack right now, sitting in 18th. So, Jeff, I want to ask you a question. We mentioned earlier for the next couple of weeks, they're going to try Joey Logano's setup here on the two car. But how difficult is that, especially in this day and age with 20-minute practice sessions and no real time to feel out what that feels like behind the wheel for Austin Cindric to just throw on Joey Logano's setup and go race it?
Yeah, Marty, it's a great question. You know, you have to wonder, you know, we're in the second year of this car. I'm sure there's been times that they've had Logano set up in that car, and he liked it or he didn't like it. It's probably just more of a commitment to saying, hey, this is how we're going to unload. We're not going to change a lot of stuff. We're not going to completely change the car for practice qualifying. We've got to learn how to make this work, and to do it, we just got to commit to it.
Blaney and Gibbs will continue to fight for the second spot, but right now it's all William Byron out in front here at Pocono. NASCAR Drive, that's your live race day companion. You're able to follow your favorite drivers with access to their in-car cameras, and then you can choose some alternate camera angles if you'd like. Customize your entire streaming experience. Visit NASCAR.com/drive, or you can download the NASCAR mobile app to watch all of the action. Ty Gibbs, we ride along right now with Ryan Blaney and that Advance Auto Parts on board. Blaney is just in front of Ty Gibbs, who started this race in the 11th spot, now running in third, Kim.
And a great run for this rookie driver. And when I was talking this morning with crew chief Chris Gale, I said this is a challenging racetrack regardless of whether you're a rookie or a veteran. What about Ty can work well here? And he said Ty has complete trust in what decisions the team is going to make strategy-wise. He just worries about driving the car the best he can. He doesn't try to suggest what to do in terms of strategy or put in things trying to meddle with what they're doing. He focuses only on driving the race car, and that is what's going to benefit him today. And, Marty, that's what we're seeing right now. Ty Gibbs in third position.
Well, Kim, how good have things been for RFK so far this year? Well, Brad Keselowski's fifth at New Hampshire last week was his fourth of 2023. He had one the entire year last year, and he'll tell you Pocono is one of his favorite and one of his better racetracks as well. The problem for Brad K and everyone who short pitted stage one, Matt McCall tells me they're still short to be able to make it to that magic number, lap 80. That's what you have to get to make it in two more stops. They'll try it maybe from 79, Parker, but they'll be at a deficit to the other cars.
Right, Marty. Our Ashley Furniture on the move. Driver has to be the number 9 of Chase Elliott starting this race. Far in the back after a spin in qualifying back at 35th, all the way up to 6th place here and fighting with Truex Jr. for that 6th position. He's been fairly quiet on the radio, only came on at one point after one of those restarts, apologizing to his teammate Alex Bowman as they sort of had a little connection there into turn 1. He apologized for that, otherwise been very happy in that number 9 car. They're up many spots, but in that similar strategy position you mentioned, as they short pitted, that's what got them up here, but they're not going to be able to connect at the end of the stage like they wanted.
Great update, and during the update, as we see the 11 of Denny Hamlin turn left to try to go under the 9. 11 looks pretty sporty, trying to recover. You see at the bottom of your screen the 8 of Kyle Busch. He's a lap down now. He's third in line. Right in front of him is Ryan Blaney in the 12. That's because of a pit stop, but nothing smooth about this pit stop. 17 seconds on pit road for the 8 car. And as a crew chief, when you call the strategy to do all this math, you don't have an extra 5 seconds built in to have a slow stop, Parker.
You see AJ Allmendinger here on pit road. He's been fairly happy at that race car right now as they go through the strategy motions. It will be 4 tires and filling it full of fuel as they go through what they believe is their strategy. A little slow there on the left side to get the jack up for AJ Allmendinger. Very happy that race car got some stage points in stage 1.
What you're seeing here is you're seeing all these drivers, so there's a lot of things going on, but the crew chiefs kind of have one guy. You know, in football, when the coach goes up and down the sidelines and the guy behind him kind of making sure he stays off the field? Well, if I'm a crew chief, I have that one engineer that his job is to make sure I don't get more than 15 seconds behind the leader. And because you get so distracted, he's hitting you on the shoulder, letting you know you need to come now if you want to pit under green. And that's the cycle we're starting to see. You know, this 47 right here of Ricky Stenhouse, he's trying to unlap himself. He had come to pit road, and now he's a lap down. So this is the struggle with it.
Kyle Busch also being scored a lap down. Only two cars that aren't out of the race.
And Kyle's closed the gap. Kyle's closed the gap to the 12 car in second, right behind this battle. So right behind Blaney as we ride on board the Advance Auto Parts camera. There it is, the 8 car going to the inside.
So to your point, Jeff, earlier, tires matter. Because Blaney's a good car, right? He's not letting Kyle Busch go. There was a question if Logano was letting somebody go at the end of stage one, but there's no way Blaney is letting the 8 go out of kindness right here. See on the left side, fuel remaining. Everybody's trying to get the lap at least 79. That's 11 more laps, trying to stretch that fuel. It all comes down to how well they did under all those yellows. Junior was a huge fan of saving gas under yellows.
Hated it.
Take a look at the progressive telemetry now. Talked about the shifting that takes place here, how much brakes they're using. We look at Ryan Blaney.
I get fascinated with just the speed. I mean, I know I've been coming here for over 2 decades, but just the place is so big that from the infield, you have a hard time just understanding how fast they're really going. Until you put this telemetry up, you're going to see, you know, over 180 miles an hour on this front stretch and then hard on the brakes.
Fifth gear there right before the flag stand.
190 miles an hour.
193 into turn one. And all the way down to 140. Bubba Wallace on pit road, Parker.
Right, he's been very tight in that race car. Came across the radio multiple times to describe that handling condition, especially at turn three. As you see the four Goodyear tires going on here for Bubba Wallace, as well as filling it full of that important fuel here. His Booty Barker has been on the radio throughout these stages and update him on the strategy and telling his spotter as well how many cars they may see pit and how that would dictate their strategy. They've stayed fluid with it, and this is what they decided here to pit at lap 69.
Back up through the gears, and another driver that is currently an out from the incident early on in this race, Joey Logano. Kim has caught up with him.
Yeah, part of that restart incident that Daniel Suarez was also a part of. What happened, and then does NASCAR need to rethink its towing situation?
Well, yeah, I mean, first off, I think, you know, it's good that we had a stage win. I get something out of the day at the Verizon Mustang. That's nice. It just seemed like on the restart, had a gap down the middle. I went down the middle and it kind of squeezed up, and as I kind of was squeezing back up, I think the 34 got me in the right rear. It's still not a great angle to tell from there, but then we just got stuck on the wall, and that's when I got drug around the racetrack for 2 miles. And I think we can make that a little better. Maybe have a tow truck with some tires on it and put some tires on it so you can at least limp it back, because it's a pretty bumpy ride. Yeah, that really doesn't do it justice right there. It really sucks, so I hope we can make that better in the future. But, you know, there's a lot of cars this week that had 4 flat tires that had to get towed in, so 2 miles is a long way that way. So hopefully we can make that a little bit better. But like I said, it stinks because we had a really fast car, obviously one that could win the stage, and just didn't get to finish it out.
Joey Logano out of the race here at Pocono.
And Logano already this season with a win. That came early, the 5th race of the season at Atlanta. So he is in the playoffs even with this accident.
Advance?
In Advance Auto Parts.
I need that diehard power.
Well, Advance Auto Parts is where diehards choose diehard.
We'll even install yours for free.
Oh, how cool is that? Cool. Oh, need a hand or?
This is how we advance.
Looks like you got a corner office. Lucky.
Part of something greater.
Hey, Jamie.
Oh, what am I up to? Just visiting a special secret client. I can't say who it is, but let's just say she bundled her dream house and her dream car for round-the-clock protection with Progressive.
Oh.
She has another house in Malibu. She's been an astronaut, an architect, a CEO.
We're in front of her house, Dave.
Well, I'd love to tell you who her boyfriend is, but I don't think I can. I'd love to tell you, but I don't think I can.
Barbie, only in theaters July 21st.
Let's go.
You don't have to be in the race to be in the race.
Here comes the 94.
Don't miss your chance to race for the million. Introducing the NASCAR Powerball Playoff.
What a power move.
Enter now for your chance to win a VIP trip for two to the NASCAR Cup Series Championship race at the Phoenix Raceway.
Win in Phoenix.
With the grand prize winner taking home $1 million. Powerball, the official lottery game of NASCAR and home to the NASCAR Powerball Playoff.
In my day, I tried keeping up with the game. Now with the power of Xfinity 10G network, my little bro is the game. With the Xfinity 10G network, he sees the game from every angle with barely any lag.
Set, hike!
My little brother, more like my big MVP. Xfinity is a game changer.
Introducing the next generation 10G network, only from Xfinity. The future starts now.
There are 16 spots in the playoffs. And just one track left. Well, not just any track.
We're basically gonna have to win.
Daytona. A last chance to keep playoff hopes alive.
We're 1 point to the good.
And for fans to experience an event unlike any other. It's time to go big.
Yeah!
And watch the drama unfold before your very eyes. Get your tickets now at DaytonaInternationalSpeedway.com.
Welcome back to Pocos. You see Tyler Reddick here on pit road as strategy starts to unfold here in stage two here in this race. Four Goodyear tires and that all-important fuel, and they are not waiting on it. Also was on pit road under break there was the 11 of Denny Hamlin. We told you earlier how he had not waited on that fuel in an earlier stop. They needed all the fuel to connect to the end of this stage like they wanted. He had to come down pit road almost six laps earlier than that team wanted to, which is going to put them in a real bind strategy-wise, Marty.
Boy, Parker, for all those teams who short-pitted stage one, it's getting to the razor's edge, including for the leader, William Byron. Listen to the radio.
Yeah, burn into the switch here. We'll pit after we hit the switch. Just don't waste any fuel. We'll need all we can get to the end.
And again, they're trying to get as close as they can to lap 80 and then connect that to 120 to make it in two more stops. So Rudy Fugle, Steve, told William Byron, run to the switch. What does that mean?
All right, so a couple things. The switch, the way that these fuel cells work, there's multiple pickups. The first one, the one you run the majority of the time, is either spaced off the floor of the cell a little bit or in a position where it doesn't pick up all the fuel. So you feel the car stumble, you turn the second switch on, kind of like reserve on the motorcycle, Rick, when we were kids. At a place like Pocono, it's probably only one lap. Now, what are they all trying to do? Why is lap 80? Listen, it's just a road trip. We're on a road trip up the East Coast. You're trying to get the lap 160. That's the end of the race. If you can run 40 for simple math, that means you need to come at 120, which means you need to come at 80. It's a little more complicated because you got some cautions and a stage end, but that's the simple way to look at it. All of these teams are going to try to stop just two more times, really close for some of them, and then one more time in the final stage, Kim.
Yep, and Ty Gibbs following that same suit. They told him, as soon as you kind of feel that, hit the switch and bring it into us. Ty reporting that car very solid, just a little bit too free.
Byron is out front by 1.8 seconds over Ryan Blaney. Then Ty Gibbs, another second back from him. And then it's 5 seconds back to Brad Keselowski. So the top four separated. But we saw on the left side of your screen, you saw how many laps they had run on fuel. And so many of these drivers look like they're about to run out of fuel. But, Steve, there's not a fuel gauge inside the car.
No, there's not a fuel gauge. You look at the fuel pressure, or the car itself will actually stumble just a little bit. And that's when you flip that switch.
We're on you. We're within a lap, but you have to flip it, and then we can run a lap.
There you go. So Rudy Fugle says, hey, William, don't be concerned if this thing stumbles a little bit. Just reach up and flip the switch. Don't run the thing completely out of gas and get it shut off. And then run, you know, finish that lap and come to us on pit road. So this is not a new thing. It's been around a couple, or at least 10 years or so, Parker.
Also, some more pit stops happen here as you see Ross Chastain on pit road. He was 27 seconds behind the leader, so inevitably most likely will go a lap down until William Byron's able to hit pit road. Very tight in that race car, just not been able to make it handle the way he wants, just struggling to get the front end to turn.
Well, so now that whole 15-second thing's kind of behind you, because if you're running the lap 80, you're going to run it for as much fuel as you have in. The one of Chastain probably just needed gas, because to Parker's point, there goes the leader. He's going to be a lap down, but everybody hopes the leader will pit before the yellow comes out. Right now, you're kind of holding the breath if you're the crew chief of the one. You just don't want to ill-timed yellow while you are the car lap down.
Parker.
Also on pit road in the 17 of Chris Buescher, who's 12 seconds behind the leader, Steve. So this should work out a little better for them. They're able to get stage points in stage one. This will also be four Goodyear tires and Sunoco fuel filling it full as they can here for the 17. He's just struggling through the bumps in turn two over this last run.
So there's a little difference. You saw earlier that the 11, we were supposed to let the jack down, wait on the gas. The way that Chris Buescher's team does it is, no. You still leave on the jack. We're going to take care of it. That's great work by the jack man. You know, he just did that work. It's easy to forget. You watched him stare at that fuel guy until the fuel guy nodded and down the jack went.
Yeah, I don't like telling the driver wait on the fuel. I like the signal to be the same all the time. When the left side drops, that's when you go. Six car, Keselowski on pit road. Marty.
And, you know, Jeff, the other interesting thing for Steve from back in the day, you know, now crew chiefs have the SMT data, so it's a little less guesswork. So Matt McCall makes the call to bring Brad Keselowski in, running fourth at the time. At one point in the run, he said, that's all I've got, but said the car just chattering the front tires is his biggest handling issue. Going to pack it full of fuel, hoping they can make a long run here. And look how long they're waiting on the fuel. That's the penalty, Steve, of waiting so long and they actually have to back them up there. That's going to cost them a ton of time.
It's going to cost him a ton of time. There's kind of a third look as you saw the pit crew guy with his hand there, kind of like an IndyCar open wheel style. You don't go until the guy releases you. Now we see William Byron, the leader, as well as Ryan Blaney, second, dive to pit road together. Now it'll be interesting to see their strategy on getting the cars full of fuel, Marty.
Yeah, this will be a little bit of a longer stop, and Rudy Fugel did warn William Byron about that. He said his biggest issue is too free, especially off turn three. That's where the handling issue for him. They're going to have to wait on that Sunoco fuel. Ryan Blaney said his car was way too tight across the tunnel, and that was really bothering him. Christopher Bell, also on pit road, said, I like the car way better on this run. And look how long they have to wait on the fuel with these longer stops. You can't short fill here. You got to go as long as you can if you want to make it on one more stop. Austin Cindric also on pit road said, I like the balance much better, car tighter on this run. That's what he wanted. Now those who went to all the way to the end of stage one, they have the advantage. We'll see when Truex and all those guys will come to pit road.
So Rick, remember, it doesn't take longer to fuel than it used to. It takes less time to change tires.
And we're welcoming in the viewers of the IndyCar race. It's just concluded from Iowa, the doubleheader taking place there. And right now we're in green flag pit stops taking place out in front. Ty Gibbs is leading. Parker.
Right, as you see Chase Elliott on pit road right now, have used great strategy to get track position as Race falls a lap later than his teammate in William Byron and filling it full of fuel. Also the bottom of your screen, Michael McDowell's had a stellar top 15 run throughout this race, got stage points in stage one, went all the way to lap 80 here, and you see them waiting on that fuel, waiting. That's all part of the strategy there as he's away.
That's got to seem like forever if you're a driver. Jeff, to your point, you're sitting in there, you don't hear the guns anymore, changing tires, just waiting on that gas.
And Ty Gibbs, they needed a couple more laps, a little bit more time than Blaney and Byron because their fuel mileage not quite as good as them this year. You see Ty on pit road, it's going to be four fresh Goodyear tires, making sure they're filling that up. There's the second can of Sunoco fuel. Ty just a little bit free on that run as they make sure they get that fuel cell full, Marty.
To the magic number that James Small wanted, working lap 82, gives them enough cushion here, they think, to be able to make it on one more stop and maybe even an overtime finish here. Martin Truex Jr. said, I would like to be a little more aggressive, especially on the exits. That's my biggest problem, but they've been very happy with the car on the 19. You also see Ryan Preece here on pit road as well. 14 to go here in stage two. And again, they'll stay out in theory here at the end of the stage as well.
So Jeff, the one thing I do like about the driver having to wait for the jack to go down is with the car being flat, you do get an extra maybe couple quarts, 3 quarts of gas in because the way the air gets trapped in the system. So I know it's more responsibility, but I do think there is an advantage to it. That's why they do it. But I love watching these stops because every week we talk about jack men, tire carriers, tire changers. Let's not forget about the fuel guys. They're only allowed to fuel, so we don't talk about them normally. But you saw that athleticism. Remember, they go back and get the can, Kim, and come back with the second can all on their own.
And you're seeing onboard from Austin Dillon, the chassis adjustment just a little bit too free on that car. Four tires, Sunoco fuel for Austin Dillon, and you're going to see them wait until they get that fuel cell full.
Saw the nod from the gas man as Austin sped away from his pit stall.
Yeah, gas men are like linemen. This gas can is 90, 95 pounds, 100 pounds. So watch this 54. Gas man has to sidestep because he's long in the box, two steps. Now watch him step back. We're going to let the tire changer underneath. And watch this exchange right here. Can out. That's 90 pounds right away. I mean, he hits it at full speed. Great efficiency by the gas man. And this is something that's hard to practice because at live pit practice, you don't like to use fuel because of the danger, so they dump water a lot. Everything just feels a little different. So great work by gas man up and down pit road.
If you are sitting there as a driver and you want, your crew chief says, hey, leave on me, then what you need is constant communication. Stay, 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 go. Like, you don't need to just let the driver sit there and feel the jack fall without constantly talking to him, because in a normal pit stop, Junior, the jack falling is the signal. When that jack falls, that's when you go. If you're going to change something, you need to over-communicate.
That's right. Repeat it a couple times. Every time you're going to do something unique, you have to have the spotter, the crew chief, continue to repeat what's going to be different about this particular stop.
For those of you that have just joined us, right now you see Larson and Harvick up at the top of the list here. Well, Larson was running second and actually spun. Had a little bit of help in turn number one. That relegated him all the way to the back. So a little bit of strategy here has put Larson up front. Harvick came to pit road a little bit earlier than everyone else, so he's on a different strategy.
Well, you see William Byard in seventh, right? He has almost a full tank of gas, best position for those situations. Caution's going to kind of change everything. 11 laps to go in the stage. But I like what Larson's doing. You mentioned it. And at some point, you can only kind of do with the cards you're dealt. He didn't mean to get spun out into turn one.
About 9-tenths of a second separating Larson and Harvick, now running 1 and 2 with 11 laps to go in stage two.
Wendy's is open until midnight or later. So give in to those cravings. Get that Baconator.
Give me one honk if you want a Baconator.
Let me get that beep beep for 6 strips of bacon. Oh, there it is.
When I say bacon, you say ater, bacon.
Woo! Let me get a toot on the mega.
All right.
Okay. Now, when I say...
Dude.
Sorry.
When the craving strikes, go night mode and choose wisely. Choose Wendy's Baconator.
In my day, I tried keeping up with the game. Now with the power of Xfinity 10G Network, my little bro is the game. With the Xfinity 10G Network, he sees the game from every angle with barely any lag. My little brother, more like my big MVP. Xfinity is a game changer.
Introducing the next generation 10G network, only from Xfinity. The future starts now.
Time to meet your team.
Who wants to race?
Be part of something greater.
The Bush Guide, cold and smooth survival skills.
Stop.
Leaves of 3, leave them be. Cans of 6, take your pick.
And head for the mountains of...
Advance?
In Advance Auto Parts.
I need that diehard power.
And the reliability and rugged durability, right?
Yes.
That's why diehards choose diehard.
And Advance Auto Parts is the home of diehard. We'll even install yours for free.
Abuela?
She makes the best tamales.
This is how we advance.
There's a thin line in the NASCAR Xfinity Series between winning and losing, between being the future and being past, between headlines and tailspins, between making history and being it, between the sweet taste of victory and the fumes of defeat. In the NASCAR Xfinity Series, there's a thin line between being a name they know and being a name they'll never forget.
Fans, download the official app of NASCAR. It allows you to follow the action with free live scoring. There's in-car cameras as well as radio broadcasts. You can also upgrade to premium for full access to driver audio channels. And there's an ad-free experience. Search NASCAR in your app store, and you can start a free trial today. All right, guys, let's take a look at the Ruoff Mortgage Keys to Victory Lane now with 72 laps remaining in this race.
Well, the field's completely jumbled up. Who's made the right pick call? Who will continue to make the right pick calls with seven laps to go in the stage?
Yeah, restarts, survive them, but you also have to advance in them. Certainly missing the wrecks is going to be big, but it's a chance to pick up spots. You have to be aggressive.
A shift happens a lot around this racetrack. Down in turn one, now in the tunnel. Used to not shift there at all, but now they're shifting in the tunnel as well. Who can take advantage of that acceleration out of the corners, downshifting in each corner, make their cars go faster?
And fuel. Drivers hate to hear it, but regardless of the strategy, we are not sitting here putting extra in just as much as we need. Who manages it correctly to get through the last 72 laps of this race?
Steve, you had mentioned if you wanted to, you could go 40-40-40 as far as when you come to pit road, as we see now Denny Hamlin and the 48 of Alex Bowman fighting for real estate.
Denny's on a little bit newer tire than Bowman. He's chased down this 48 car, but Bowman is fighting hard on the outside. Gonna side draft a little bit, try to keep him close. Almost contact right here. Bowman's fighting hard. I think he still believes, hey, I gotta fight for every point. I'm in a bad position in the points. In the playoffs, to the bubble, he's got to get every single stage point he can. Denny doesn't like it, though. He's like, I don't like you racing me so hard. I ran you down easily, and now you're going to fight this hard for this position. Finally, Bowman gives it to him in the tunnel.
Here in six laps, we're going to kind of see everybody's hand when it comes to fuel quantity, because you know who decides to pit, who decides to stay out. We've actually seen a few cars triple the pit road. Marty.
A couple cars coming here. Ryan Blaney right now sitting in the 11th position with five to go in the stage. So how hard does he push for that stage point? Listen to the conversation a moment ago.
I need to know my objective. I think I know, but do I need, are we going to get anything worth it by being burned up trying to bat this guy because I can't? Or should I just ride behind him and save my stuff?
And hold your spot, save your stuff.
So with Eric Jones pitting there, Blaney now is in the 10th position to be able to get a stage point. So Jeff, how hard is that behind the wheel? Your crew chief tells you, hey, fuel's the more important game here. You got to make it to lap 80. That's the focus. Don't burn yourself up.
You just have to trust the strategy. You just have to listen to him, understand. He understands what's going on, big picture, and just do what he asks. Now, Blaney does have a car in front of him that has much older tires. He should easily be able to bypass. There's a 21 of Harrison Burton actually pulling over for Blaney. Should easily be able to bypass him for that point. Kim.
And Kevin Harvick coming in for his stop. Just a little bit tight has been the diagnosis all race long. You see the chassis adjustment right there to free him up just a little bit. They'll wait on that fuel. And Kevin Harvick completing service under green.
Saw Harrison Burton pulling in behind him. The real question is Kyle Larson, right? You mentioned he's about to spun out. He was last on pit road, a lap 49. Can he stretch it all the way to the end of the stage and win a stage? Get that playoff point would be very important. Oh, Christopher Bell around. Wow.
Bell spins around and caution comes out. It's the sixth one of the day.
He was in 11th place right there when he lost control off of turn one.
It's going to be interesting for a few of the cars that were, I'm thinking, still planning on coming to pit road maybe. Now they got to ride around under yellow. Let's see how the 20 gets back without damaging his car. Take a look, guys.
All by himself right here, just loose. Back comes around on the corner exit of turn one.
And Christopher Bell just trying to be aggressive in the gas. It just spins out. I talked to Christopher this morning, and he said, look, we've got speed. We just got to quit making mistakes. And he was talking about himself and his pit crew, and that one's on him. Kyle Larson coming to pit road. Caution came out. He could not get on pit road. Most likely, I couldn't see the lights, but most likely it would have been a violation because the caution lights came on before he was on pit road. So wisely turned out.
Kim.
It was interesting to listen to the radio because it was pit, pit, pit from Cliff Daniels. And then as soon as he saw that incident in the caution, he said, stay out, stay out, stay out. Now, Larson was right on the edge of that fuel window. Obviously, caution laps a little less costly than under green. They have told him, save as much as you can. This caution is going to run to the end of the stage. Then once they open pit road, you're going to be right on the edge of it. So save as much as you can.
So that's the concern. So you definitely can save a lot under yellow. But first of all, if you run out under yellow on the front stretch, you're not going to coast back around without being at speed. And he has to run three more laps, see the green and white, and a fourth lap to get to pit road. So, you know, four laps, oh, ho-hum, 10 miles. I mean, that's a lot of – I mean, that looks like a concern.
Well,
Cliff Daniels.
Steve, how dangerous is it, too, that he's going to be shutting the car off and then hoping that it starts back up again because
Absolutely.
He doesn't know how much fuel he has?
Well, so his option is what? He could come with the pit road closed. I mean, that's an option. The pit, the penalty is tail end. You'll start at the back of the field. That only costs him a few spots because I don't think a whole lot of guys are coming here. There are definitely some that are coming, so it's going to cost him maybe 5 or 10 spots. Ty Dillon right behind him, he's probably hoping that the five, you know, has to come. He thinks he can win himself a stage by staying out. And William Byron is hoping the two in front of him both can't make it for his playoff point.
So the caution comes out right here at the end of stage two for Christopher Bell going around in the 20. Larson, if he's got enough fuel, he might hang on and glide across the finish line to win stage two. Stage two is going to end under caution for the NASCAR Cup Series. HighPoint.com 400 on USA. Here in Long Pond, Pennsylvania, and the Pocono Raceway. Larson was out front and actually was on his way to pit road when the 20 of Christopher Bell spun. And so right away, his crew chief said, stay out, stay out, stay out, because we could win the stage.
Well, so here we're hearing a few cars that have to come to pit road. And, you know, depending on how many come, Larson's going to restart, I don't know, maybe 15th or 20th. And if he has to pit with pit road closed, that's tail end. That's last on the field. So it's not just a stage win. Now, the stage win has some high value with that playoff point. He's shaking it around, maybe trying to fill that pickup.
Well, the other thing, Steve, you had mentioned it was four laps until the end of the stage. Well, he's going to have to go all the way around after he gets across the start-finish line here. So he can't come to pit road now. He has to finish the stage.
Well, I mean, he can come to pit road, but it's closed. He wouldn't win the stage, but if you run out of gas, you run out of gas. I mean, you have to get around, so there you go.
Will I be able to get back to pit road?
Kyle Larson.
Here's the question. Fingers crossed.
Fingers crossed. So Kyle Larson's going to win the stage. Ty Dillon second.
Ty Dillon has the same number of laps on his fuel as Larson, so if Larson has a problem with fuel, so does Ty Dillon.
Larson.
And this is the problem. So what he's doing here is the fuel is picked up in the right rear corner. Think about swinging a bucket half full of water. You can swing it over your head and the water doesn't fall out because of centrifugal force. The fuel cell is built the same way. The pickup's in the right side, so when you're turning left, it gets slung to the right under green.
A little door there to hold it in,
well,
the pickup area?
Not even a very good door anymore in these. Now, they all run the same fuel cell, so there's no more technology advantage from one team to the other. A little bit of a box to catch it, but not as cool as it used to be when they could design their own. So now he's staying on the flat and swerving to try to fill that box or the pickup up.
And another thing that this does is it doesn't allow Allmendinger, who's going to finish 11th in this stage, to get any stage points. A driver who's really bettering his chances and moving forward in that bubble battle with the points with the 99 car of Suarez wrecked out. If they continued that green flag run to the end, I believe he does cycle into 10th or even 9th place to end this stage to be able to grab a few points. But you know they're frustrated inside that car, just barely missing the top 10 for this stage two.
Before it gets too loud on pit road, let's go to pit road for KP, and let's talk a little bit about restarts, KP.
It seems like that's the only reason you guys want to talk to me, man. Listen, how did we get to this drama that we have at the end of stage two? It's all about restarts, all about restarts. We see on this restart here, everybody begins to jockey for position. They are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 wide, 7 wide. Listen, something's got to give when you're 7 wide. You can tell where 1 or 2 cars at, but you can't tell where 7 wide. We see Joey Logano gets the short end of the stick, and so does the 99 of Daniel Suarez. Both of these guys involved in wrecks. catastrophic for Daniel Suarez today. He needed points. He needed stage points, but he needed points to stay on that bubble. We see another restart here where they go down into the corner. I don't even remember who's fun on this one. There's been so many accidents. We see the 78 of BJ McLeod. He comes up and gets into the three car. Kim?
Kyle Larson on pit road. He said, with the cloud cover, it has freed up my car. I don't have the lateral grip. I had it earlier in the race. Cliff Daniels saying, we'll make an adjustment for you. Air pressure. He said, you're going to be waiting about 13 seconds for fuel. It's going to feel like a long time, but we have to get it full, Parker.
All right, the 11 of Denny Hamlin on pit road. We talked about how he didn't wait on fuel. This is the ramification that they were not able to do this on one more stop, so they had to come down four tires of fuel, Marty.
Alex Bowman said the car fired off really well, but when the sun came out, it got really slick. Also, Blake Harris asked him, what do you need for traffic? He said, a lot more turn than I have. Those are the cars that pitted, but Rick, a lot stayed out trying to make it to that magic lap 120 number for the final stop of the day.
Yeah, so many stayed out that it's going to be very chaotic again, and we've seen this already. It's happened at the pointy end of the triangle, turn number one. Everyone has had issues trying to get into turn one on restarts, and we've got another one coming up. Pit stops are done. We're getting ready for a restart as we take a look at the Toyota driver update, where they're running. Right now, Ty Gibbs, the highest running Toyota, in second. Mark Trucks Jr. is fourth. And Trucks Jr. has led a lap. Gibbs has led three laps of these Toyotas. Bell 15th, Hamlin 16th, and Wallace in 18th. Marty.
Well, Rick, talking to William Byron earlier this week, he said, after Nashville a few weeks ago in New Hampshire last week, I honestly was a little bit worried about the speed that we had at Hendrick Motorsports. So it was nice to show up this weekend and know that we brought speed, but also that we can take a few punches and still lead the regular season championship standings, or at least be close to that. So William Byron and Hendrick Motorsports have certainly shown up with the speed. Can they close it out for their fifth win of the year? That's the big question, Kim. Rudy Fugel told me they can make it to lap 122. That buys them an overtime finish on the fuel.
Well, Marty, for rookie Ty Gibbs, he is within striking distance of a playoff position. So I asked crew chief Chris Gayle this morning, what does that mean for you over the handful of the next races? And he said, we have to be way more aggressive in deciding how we're going to get in. Are we going to get in on points, or are we going to try and go for a win? We've seen an aggressive strategy today from Gibbs. Right now, he's saying that car is very solid. He feels like he can push it when he needs to. He's currently running in the fourth position, Parker.
And Kim, one of the coolest stories in NASCAR in 2023 has to be 38-year-old Michael McDowell and that 34 Front Row Motorsports team coming into this race right on the playoff bubble, 1 point to the good, and then putting together a stellar race, restarting here in eighth into stage three. And this race is a great example of what has put them here, executing at every level of this race, pitting perfectly, getting stage points in stage one, waiting on the fuel, and now pitting at lap 80. They can do this on one more stop, which should set them up for a great finish, at least in the top 10. Once again, a great season by Mike McDowell, this 34 team so far.
You mentioned the stage points. Take a look at who has earned the most today, and Hamlin tops that list with 15 stage points, Reddick with 12, Truex Jr., Logano, 10 each, as well as Larson with 10.
All right, Rick, a lot of conversation about strategy. Let's just look at this final stage. This is where we're at, right here, right? We're at the start of the stage. Everybody's trying to get to the finish. The magic is going to be about right here, about lap 120. That's the goal. Everybody needs to get to 120 to connect it. Some guys can run past 120, but new tires make a difference. So you may run two or three laps past, but I think around 118 to 122, the entire field is going to pit under green.
Door to door, side by side, once again, as Blaney gets a big shove from Ty Gibbs on that outside line.
It pushes him out clear, but they aren't together. That inside line is. Here comes the inside line back. Blaney's clear down in the turn. He slides up and takes the air away from the 24 to the inside. Truex, he won't make the pass, but he slots into second place in front of Byron. Way up the racetrack here, the back of the field. Looks like Cole Custer up in the race, up in the wall there, as these cars jockey for position down the Long Pond Straight.
That was Eric Jones in the 43 that ducked way to the inside.
Bubba Wallace as well, Rick, three wide down into the corner, taking a few spots.
The wave around went to the 14 of Chase Briscoe and the 38 of Todd Gilliland. So they took the wave around to get back on the lead lap.
31 cars in the lead lap, and you see them all right here. Guys, William Byron, are you surprised? Two restarts, he's lost the lead. That's shocking.
Just hasn't worked out. I mean, here comes the 19 down to the inside. Going to try to upset the air on the 12 car. Can't really do it. Falls in line. They're going to run down the long pond stretch. Byron slightly gaining on these guys, I imagine, as they try to race side by side through one and two.
See a little bit of draft from Truex gaining on Blaney down this straightaway. Now they go in the corner. This is where it gets very difficult for Truex. No air on that car.
Byron up the racetrack back there.
That's the gap between one and two.
Here's Kyle Busch getting in the wall just a little bit, if at all, coming off of turn one.
Here comes the race for the lead again. Martin Truex Jr. to the inside. A big run on the 12.
He side drafts, moves way down the racetrack, continues that forward momentum. Look how far ahead. Oh, the Blaney giving up another spot. Is there a problem with the 12 down the front straightaway there? He's to the bottom of the racetrack. Looks like he's a little bit off the pace, guys. The 54 coming around the outside.
Must have lost so much momentum.
It feels fine, Junior. Yeah, he said it feels fine, Rick. I just have no power. I don't know what's going on, but still losing spots for Ryan Blaney.
Well, it might feel fine, but it does not look fine. If he feels like it has no power, it has to be some sort of mechanical issue for this 12 car, because to your point, Junior, they're going by him. I mean, look how quickly the cars behind close in, and they're side by side.
Trying to listen to see if there's anything wrong with the engine.
It sounds normal, but obviously the acceleration is not there.
We saw over 190 miles an hour easy at the end of the straightaway. And this thing is only topping out at like barely 180, and you can see there's nothing the driver's going to be able to do at pure straight line speed.
So a problem for Blaney after taking the lead, has lost it. Martin Truex Jr. now has a half a second lead over William Byron.
You have to wonder if they broke a spring or something in the rocker system. The downshifting here, if sometimes you get a little aggressive downshifting a little too early, over revving that engine.
Reddick goes by in the 45.
Some guys downshift down in the middle of the corner at low RPMs. But then sometimes you want to downshift early and use that engine braking to balance the car into the corner and help the car rotate and even slow the car down. Stay off the brake pedal, not use all the brakes, only to slow the car down as we continue seeing great battles back through the field.
Yeah, we saw three wide there, of which Kevin Harvick was right in the middle of it. Yeah, look at speed comparison. He is 8 miles an hour slower than race leader Martin Truex Jr.
It's a battle for seventh right here with Denny Hamlin in the four car of Harvick. As Keselowski looks on, Harvick battling hard around the outside, making this a difficult spot for Denny to get. And Keselowski loses the air on the nose of his car and gives up the spot to Chase Elliott in the nine car. Chase moving into ninth place.
Harvick not giving an inch through three here.
Yeah, I love it. I like when these guys race each other like crazy. They get frustrated. They make mistakes.
Into turn one, these two will be side by side. Hamlin, will he try to go a little bit deeper into one?
Harvick dives into the corner, trying to stay there, Rick, and he's gonna do it.
Both back into the gas, and Harvick still surges ahead.
Do you hear that? The microphone, it's kind of in the front bumper of the 4, and when the front bumper got next to the exhaust, the 11, it really gave you a great sound of what the exhaust sounds like, and it was clear that he was still to his outside.
And Hamlin trying to use all the racetrack he can, trying to kind of run Harvick up a little bit clean, but just an aggressive move off the corner. Nice. Harvick trying to squeeze the 11.
The 11 up the track a little bit here, taking the line away. There's contact right there.
While those two are side by side, here comes the 9 of Chase Elliott.
And he chose the 4 car to push down the straightaway rather than making it 3 wide.
Man.
He pushed the 4 right past the 11 of Denny Hamlin.
That's so frustrating for Denny, and he'll have to go back to work. Oh, crash!
Into the wall hard. And Austin Dillon, for the second time, around in turn one, this time a hard contact with that wall and fire under the hood.
It was a hard lick. The car got turned around, right rear first.
See him throwing the steering wheel, frustrated, disgusted with what's just happened.
He was running an 11th.
Man, that was a huge impact. We have seen over the years, turn one at Pocono, some just massive, massive wrecks.
Well, we saw the speeds over 190 miles an hour by some. Take a look at what happens.
Three wide down into one. That's Austin on the inside. And, oh, Austin's in the middle. Just comes down the racetrack into the 45 of Reddick.
I'd like to get another look at that. It almost looked like Austin didn't know he was there. But
right.
That was just a first glance at it. Here we go. Yeah, I think he's expecting maybe that Reddick's going to be lower on the racetrack.
Yeah, that's two guys going for the same piece of asphalt. Used to be teammates at RCR.
You see the contact now, and now Austin just along for the ride. There's nothing he can do. Locks it down. Big hit.
Oh, helmet thrown at Reddick.
Angry. And I can see his argument, but I can also see Reddick saying, hey, man, you know, I felt like you crowded me on the entry, but it's such a dangerous entry
at
high speed. You've got to have a little give and take there. Or that's the that'll be the result, right? When those guys are going to refuse and argue down into the corner.
And, you know, going into turn one from where we are, spotters are just above us, 3,000 feet away, down into turn one, going away from you. So I don't think the spotter, that's a call, in my opinion, you guys as drivers need to make.
Exactly.
I'm not sure I can help you. I might tell you, hey, man, listen, 45's in there, can't tell. And you have to decide whether that guy's going to give you the spot or not. Obviously, by Austin's reaction, he had a clear opinion on what should have happened.
Yeah, they both know, everybody knows where each other is at this moment, and it is on the drivers to sort this out, as you point out. The three coming down the racetrack, and he's coming down into the line of the 45 car. I mean, you know, I know he's upset about Reddick turning him there, but he steers down the racetrack, and they make contact. Reddick not.
Ouch. So I'm with you. I really want to hear what Austin has to say when he's out of the infield care center,
right?
Because visually, the 45 is a long ways up the door of the three. I feel he is in position. Now, we don't know how he got there. Like, what did he do to get into that position? Obviously, Austin has a very strong opinion, as now we see a few cars on pit road, Marty.
Yeah, you're going to see Ryan Blaney come down pit road, a host of others here as well, taking advantage of this. That will make their next stop a little bit shorter for Ryan Blaney and Jonathan Hassler. As you see Brad Keselowski on pit road for Hassler, they're trying to diagnose exactly what's going on. But Jonathan Hassler going through all the maps, Steve, and all the codes on the car, they think it's a drivetrain issue for Ryan Blaney. So how long could that last for Blaney for the rest of the race with 53 to go?
Well, rarely do they fix themselves. Let's listen in. Just listen to what it sounds like.
Doesn't sound right.
No. So here's the situation. It's very simple. This is an electronics. Remember, this is electronic fuel injection, EFI. You can reset it if it's a spark and fuel situation that can be reset by the computer. But, Junior, if it's your point, valve spring, broke a valve, it's dropped down, a rocker, something in the upper part of the engine. It's going to last until they take that thing out and send it back to Roush Yates and rebuild it, because it's broken. It's an unfortunate day for the 12, but I think it just proves how hard. Like speed, we talk about speed. How do you find speed? More horsepower.
Well, you don't want to make any assumptions because we don't know what's going on, but we do know that Ford and Yates and Roush, they've been working really hard on creating more power, and when you do that, it does get dangerous to break in. We don't know that's what happened, but you get aggressive, things happen.
Big hit here for Dillon. Slamming passenger side into the turn one wall, disappointed and not happy with the driver of the 45.
A another massive wreck here at Pocono. Let's talk about car improvements. Go back to Talladega. This very scary crash between Ryan Preece and the 5 of Kyle Larson. On board, watch this. And now we're going to take a look at the driver of Preece. Watch the hit he takes. And then the result of the 5 car, the hole in the right side, door bars. You see through the right side. So NASCAR made a bunch of improvements to the rear of the car over the winter. They said, we're not done. We're going to make changes middle of the season if necessary. One big change implemented at Atlanta, the right side. The left side had it. The right side now has it. That boilerplate, solid steel. Very important for that impact that the 3 of Austin Dillon just took. Also in the front, this upper square crossmember gone completely. The red V behind it also gone. They want more areas to crush, so we're going to go in. We're actually going to remove an entire bar. A piece of 2x3 between the uprights gone. The things that are left, they have to be there. We're going to put some slots, some holes, allow things to crush easier and better. Remember, the drivers say, hey, I know how you designed it, but we're feeling this. They even went to the front bumper, which is aluminum, and put different slots in that, in all an attempt to deform, right? And when you look at this 3 impact, it is violent. Right rear, right side, right front, a huge hit. I mean, look at that car. That's how we want them to look, Rick. We want them to fold up, take some of that load away from the driver.
Yeah, so many impacts that we have seen out of race cars, especially last year, resulted in drivers that had to sit out because there was injuries that were involved. And so NASCAR, as you mentioned, went to work and tried to make it a little bit easier. But still, you have to remember, this is a very dangerous sport. These cars are going 190 miles an hour. And back to green we go from Pocono. Martin Truex Jr. in the 19. He is on the outside. William Byron on the inside trying to fight to hold on to that second spot. He's lost spots on restarts.
4 wide in the backside of the top 20 there, Rick. Now down to 3 wide. Little contact. Car's getting off of turn 2.
Byron now with a little bit of a shove. Ty Gibbs pushing him into the tunnel turn.
Denny back here on the inside of the 9 of Chase Elliott. Trying to stay there off the tunnel, can't do it. Now Bubba Wallace, Ty Gibbs going at it.
2 Toyotas fighting for position.
Ty's going to try to stay there, Bubba up the racetrack. Ty's going to keep that car on the outside and have the momentum down this long straightaway.
Bubba gives the spot up, rolls in behind him to keep the guys from behind him catching up to him. Kim.
Austin Dillon out of the care center got caught up in an incident after having a great run today. We saw the displeasure with Tyler Reddick. What happened and what message were you trying to send him?
That I was mad. I don't know. I heard Junior's replay said that I came down a little bit. I felt like I was holding my own. He was at my left rear going in there. I knew we were 3 wide. I think I've got the right to at least hold my lane. I mean, I got to turn at some point to get down. Brad's on my outside, maybe a half lane up. But Tyler drove it in there. Obviously, I feel like he drove it in deep enough where he had to come up the track into me. We can look at the SMT and see the little fine movements that we make. But felt like that was not the time to do that when in the 45. Hate it for our Bretz-Free team. We really sucked at the beginning of the race. We got the car much better. Made some good strategy moves. But, you know, just lived to fight another day, I guess. That was a pretty rough hit. But, yeah.
Was the helmet throw enough, or do you need to talk to Tyler?
No, I just need to start wrecking some people.
There you have it. Austin Dillon not happy.
Interesting opinion. Junior, yeah. You already had your analysis of it.
Yeah.
You know, look, I'm not going to tell him he's wrong. He's the guy that rode the car into the fence at 190 miles an hour, but I will say that, you know, I thought the 45 was, it wasn't like a last-minute dive bomb. He was kind of there for the majority of the straightaway. I don't know. It's not going to be the last 2 drivers that debate about real estate in turn 1. Maybe not the last 2 in this race.
Yeah. So Brad Keselowski taking the short line around there, and Justin Haley in the 31 on the outside of him.
Let's talk about Brad Keselowski and the 7 of Corey LaJoie. Both pitted under this final, under the most recent yellow at lap 107. The goal for these 2 is try to stay in touch, because when we see green flag pit stops, I'm thinking gas and go. Try to save time on pit road. We'll see if that's enough time. But right now, they're kind of going as fast as they could go, past as many as they can. Good recovery by the 7, and the 6 has really had a great race all day.
Is there any way that they could go all the way to the end of this stage? I mean, is saving fuel? They're going to have to stop again. You had mentioned earlier 38 to 42 was kind of the fuel window.
Yeah, they're going to have to stop. It's just not going to be a very long stop, just a splash. So you hope it happens where you can make up a lot of run. I think this 11 of Denny Hamlin has everybody's attention a little bit. He's in eighth position. Carr looks great, has tons of speed as he kind of turns to the bottom of the four, but it's just so hard to work your way through traffic.
And he's been trying to pass Harvick for a long time now. We saw them racing really hard many laps ago, and Denny's back again at the back bumper of this Hunt Brothers Pizza camera. As we look back on the 11, he dives down into the turn one. Harvick to the bottom of the track. Parker, what you got?
Now keep your eye on them because Hamlin was not happy with Kevin Harvick after they raced that side-by-side and for those many laps, and Harvick just would not let him go. And as you're seeing here, Steve, you pointed out, the 11's been able to move through the field since restarting back at 16th, and they had to make that pit stop. And Chris Gabehart sort of sold them on it by saying, you're going to have 12-lap newer tires and a lot more fuel than the cars in front of you. We can still get to the front of this race. And he's showing that with that fast race car to drive it into the top 10 and be knocking the door of the four car right there.
Well, one reason Denny Hamlin's frustrated is a little with Kevin Harvick. It's going to be a little bit with himself. Let's just be fair. The end of stage one, Martin Truex Jr. was second. Denny Hamlin was third. So they are, we're on the same pit strategy. It was when Hamlin didn't wait on gas. Parker showed it live. It was so well done by Parker saying, hey, the 11's messed up. He's short on gas. They've been playing catch up. That forced this extra pit stop. And deep down, Hamlin knows he could beat Truex up there leading that race. And now he gets to the outside of the four.
And that's the lane he wants. He wants to be on the outside. He knew how hard it was to pass on the inside. Easily gets around Harvick. Now he carries on. Takes the fight up here to Buescher in sixth place.
And if he was frustrated, he waved when he went by Harvick there. He did put the hand out and waved.
Well, you become less frustrated when you pass a guy you're mad at. That tends to make you happy, yeah. That's just hard racing, though. Nobody did anything wrong there. There's just, it's hard to pass at this racetrack. When somebody holds you up, you get frustrated, but that's why it's fun to watch. And actually, it's why it's fun to do. I mean, if it was easy to pass somebody, everybody could do it. That's why these are the best in the business.
But you can see how good this 11 car is and how much distance he's put on the 4 car. Driving right up to the back bumper of the 17 now. Trying to take that position here as he goes off into turn one. Getting down to the inside.
Trying to get by Buescher and right on his back bumper as they go through one. It's Martin Truex Jr. who's out front.
When you look back on this day, you might remember the heat wave or the kiddie pool that definitely looked bigger online or a burst of strawberry shortcake flavor and real strawberries swirled into an icy slush topped with vanilla ice cream and flurries of sweet, crunchy sugar crystals. Greg, however, will never forget the homemade water slide incident. Sonic 299 Strawberry Shortcake Snowball Slush Float. Mmm, Sonic.
A guy like this who relies on his truck for work knows that his truck will take care of him, that he takes care of his truck. And WeatherTech has always been the ultimate protection. From floor liners to no-drill mud flaps to tech liner for your truck bed to bump step to the handy underseat storage system. And Cup Phone keeps phones secure in any cup holder. Order your American-made products at WeatherTech.com.
Why wait until November when Black Friday deals are going on now at Ashley? Take advantage of low monthly payments with 0% interest through July 2028 in-store only. Plus, shop doorbusters starting at just $2.99. Shop and save today only at Ashley.
The Bush Guide, cold and smooth survival skills. If you encounter a black bear, do not run. Instead, speak firmly in a loud voice. Bush. Head for the mountains.
In my day, I tried keeping up with the game. Now with the power of Xfinity 10G Network, my little bro is the game. With the Xfinity 10G Network, he sees the game from every angle with barely any lag.
Set, hike!
My little brother, more like my big MVP. Xfinity is a game changer.
Introducing the next generation 10G Network, only from Xfinity. The future starts now.
NASCAR is on USA. It's a race for the playoffs. The drama. The excitement.
Oh, attacks made!
The characters.
I believe what I just saw.
Next up, Richmond.
It's so easy to overdrive the corners here.
Kevin Harvick is going to win in Richmond.
NASCAR, next Sunday, 2:30 Eastern on USA.
Back at Pocono, 41 laps to go in the race, and here come the final stops of the day. Blake Harris making the call for Alex Bowman to bring him to pit road here. It's going to be fuel in the Goodyear tires, and they hope the fuel to make it to the very end. You're going to see a lot of teams scramble now for that final stop of the day to try and get to the end of this race.
And a lot of ingredients are going into the soup here, Rick. Now you have to be good on and off pit road, but also how much fuel do you need? How many tires are you going to take? I expect to see four tires for most everybody up front, but some of these other drivers with a little bit bigger fuel load, maybe like LaJoy, Stenhouse, Keselowski at the bottom, they might be gas only, so it's really going to mix up the entire running order. Here we go. We got William Byron on pit road now, kind of the first of the top three. And the reason you pit right away, even if you could run a couple laps, is you don't want the caution to come out, because then that would mess you up. Parker.
Chris Buescher is one of those that now decides to come pit road in that 17th from the top 10. A solid run for them throughout this race. As you'll see, those four tires go on and fill it full of fuel, Marty.
William Byron, pit stall number one, so the balance is really close. I need a little more front grip, especially through the tunnel turn. You see Buescher on the top of your screen making his stop. Austin Cindric also on pit road. This will be interesting because Cindric and also Brad Keselowski, who were here, needed fuel only. So we'll see if they gain some track position through that move.
Well, Brad was putting four tires on. I thought fuel only as well, Marty. I was right on board with you. All right, here comes the leader, the 19 of Truex.
Chase Elliott also making his way onto pit road. Parker.
I see the 23 of Bubba Wallace who have pit out of the top five. A stellar run coming together for them as they've used strategy to get some of that track position. But most importantly, they've just had a fast car in that 23. Just a little tight, but they've been working on it and starting to free him up. There's top of your screen. You see Chase Elliott also on pit road through this strategy, Marty.
Martin Truex Jr. was leading for much of that run. Parker said, I could stand to be just a little bit more aggressive with the throttle on exit, waiting on fuel. Truex revving the engine, saying, hey, I'm ready to go. We'll see where he cycles out.
Well, we're going to see Truex blending off from pit road. The five of Kyle Larson, the first car to have service and fuel. The five of Kyle Larson pits a lap 120. For two tires, and now he is going to assume the lead of this race through the cycle. Big move by the five of Larson, 19 of Truex, 48 of Bowman. Now we have Ty Gibbs on pit road.
And Ty had no major complaints about the car, said, I still feel like I can push it when I want to. As you see, the right side tires going on, they'll take a tear off, and they will take four tires on this green flag stop to give him just a little bit of an advantage, they think.
Now Ty Gibbs is thinking, I want to get in front of the five. You see it up here on the top of your screen, right on the shape of the track. The five's on the front stretch, 54. Oh, this one's not going to be close. Kyle Larson easily is going to pass the 54. What a call by Cliff Daniels to come in, take two tires, short work on pit road. And Kyle Larson has leapfrogged to control of the race. He's not leading. He's in the 14th position. But confidently, in front of him, everyone needs fuel. So he absolutely is the leading car that we think can make it to the finish.
What are the strategy comes into play as far as the guys who came on lap 109 or 107 or, you know, the ones that are just in front of him?
Well, your fear right now is a caution coming out, so you don't want to wait too long, but you're going to run a little bit to give yourself a bank in case there's a green-white checker. We've seen multiple. You have enough fuel. You also, maybe, now that you see how you've cycled out, two tires, gas only, you have an idea what math you're working with. You kind of have the questions on the SAT. You didn't know what test you were taking. Now you have them, like right here.
Kim.
And just fuel for Chase Briscoe. You saw him wait there. They're hoping to gain a little track position, not changing tires on that.
I always did better at tests I knew the questions to, Rick.
Well, now everybody knows the questions.
Well, now for Hamlin, you know, he's just trying to run as fast as possible. He just ran a 53.8 leading this race. Now he comes to pit road. So it's kind of like an overcut, right? Run fast with no traffic. Let's see what him and Harvick do and see where they blend. Kim.
And here is Kevin Harvick. Typically, he likes to take four tires, but I'm hearing the call is going to be two tires, right side only for Kevin Harvick as they wait to get a little bit of fuel. And it is two tires for Kevin Harvick, Parker.
Right, as we saw Hamlin also on pit road. That was the key there, right? And he was going to turn fast. That's just right side tires for him as well, waiting on that fuel.
All right, so the 11 hold serve of these two, but this two tires, Kyle Larson by us at the front stretch. Let's see what the 5 and the 11 do. The 11's leading. I don't think he's going to have enough speed. If he does, Larson is barely going to sneak by. Now the 11 is trying to get right up to momentum. Two car lengths is the only gap the 5 now has over the 11. Now Denny knows this in his mind is for the race win.
Remember, Larson's on two tires as well. Denny on fresh two tires, so he needs to know that. He needs to know. Go on offense right here. Take advantage of the newer tires. Try to get by him right now.
So how did this all happen? Well, the 5 was 11th, 7 seconds back, but he only had a 4.5 second pit stop for two tires. The 19 had a 12 second pit stop for four tires. That is how this has got jumbled up. 35 to go. Larson, Hamlin, and Truex is back there thinking to himself, what happened? I was leading. What happened? And I don't think the 19 did anything wrong. Let's be honest. I think they're calling a great race.
We see Larson is running in the 10th spot right now, and that's because all 9 spots in front of him will have to come to pit road for fuel before the end of this race.
And to compare lap times between Larson, the 11, and Truex, Larson quicker right there that last time by. So Truex with those tires isn't easily tracking down this 5 car.
Larson had the fastest lap last time by. Truex was second fastest, and Ty Gibbs had the third fastest lap. Gibbs is back there in 16th.
And so far, this 11 hasn't been able to really eat into the deficit between him and the 5 cars. Pretty much stay the same since they come off pit road. Larson has nothing but clean air in front of him for many laps, so he's taking advantage of that as well.
Wow, and those three just ran 53 sixes. It is time to go. So that's why Reddick, Jones, Stenhouse, LaJoy, Burton, Almirola, Gilliland, even Yaley, the reason we're not mentioning their names is because they're losing about a half a second a lap to these cars. We're confident they can't make it on fuel.
The cars they were racing, though, you know, remember they were racing for 20th, 22nd, whatever. They're not losing pace to them because all those cars are in a bunch, and they're going actually a little bit slower. So those guys now are in clean air. Although they may not be racing for the win, it may help them gain some spots to get a better finish.
It's a great point. We talk a lot about the race win, but if you're Jones or Stenhouse, LaJoy, this could easily improve yourself 5 or 7 spots in the final running order.
All right, guys, let's go through the field brought to you by eBay. Parker, we're going to start with you.
Right now at the front of this field is Tyler Reddick, but this race has really gotten away from this 45 team, similar to other races we've heard from them over the last 6 races, where they've just had certain things pop up, like that incident there with Austin Dillon at the beginning of the race. The car wasn't quite where Tyler wanted, so they lost a couple positions early, and it just hasn't been a smooth race for them, and now they find themselves in a position where they will have to pit again. They cannot make it from here in that 45, Marty.
Same for Erik Jones, who sits in the second position. It's been a much better 6 to last 7 weeks for this 43 team, trying to find some momentum. Dave Ellens has kept him out since lap 90. That was their last stop. Clearly, Erik Jones will not be able to make it the rest of the way on fuel. How about Ricky Stenhouse Jr. sitting up in third right now? Mike Kelly's got him in an interesting spot. They're thinking fuel only with about 14 to go. We'll see where all that cycles out, but Stenhouse has never finished in the top 10 here at Pocono. Could it happen today, Kim?
Well, Corey LaJoy runs in the 4th position. They will have to stop again for fuel, but Corey had a great weekend. He transferred to the 2nd round of qualifying for the first time in his career, and he called that a small win, and that's what this team is looking for, small wins. Corey LaJoy reporting tight on that machine right now. He's running right in front of Harrison Burton. I talked to the team this morning. Crew Chief Brian Wilson told me it is all about learning. We are in a learning stage, and what we need to do to learn is we need to complete all the laps here. Harrison complaining of lack of overall grip, just a little bit free in turns 1 and 3, Parker.
And for Erik Almirola in that 10 car, this weekend started a bit awry as they were very loose in the start of practice and through qualifying. They've worked on that race car as much as they could, and they've used great strategy to get track position here, also pinning lap 107, as you see that for the 10 running 6, and trying to make something of a weekend that really started with them off and very loose inside that race car, Kim.
And you see now Gilliland in the 38. He had an incident in qualifying, had to start from the rear of the field. Obviously, strategy putting him out in the top 10. They will have to pit again to make it on fuel. But Gilliland just saying the biggest struggle right now has been the handling throughout the day. Great run, though, running in the top 10. In front of J.J. Yealy in the eighth position. J.J., what a rebound. He had that early spin. Right now, just complaining a little bit, lacking lateral grip on that machine, Marty.
Kim, Ryan Blaney's in the ninth spot, dealing with that down a cylinder situation, trying to limp at home. Jonathan Hassler playing any card he can at this point. But right now, riding on board with the Advanced Auto Parts camera, you can clearly hear the engine, not what Blaney needs right now, hoping to limp at home, Kim.
And Kyle Larson, they feel very confident about their chances, knowing the cars in front of them have to pit for fuel. Crew Chief Cliff Daniels did the math before these green flag stops and assured his driver, we are in a prime position. What a rebound for Kyle Larson after an early incident and having to fix that car, Parker.
And you can say the same about Denny Hamlin, as he pointed out, from that mistake of going too early to stop and not getting that car fold and now being positioned to fighting for this win. The team has told him that the five in front of him could be very close on fuel to still push and try and get by him, but to know that he is very close on fuel. Marty.
Growing larger in his mirror is his teammate Martin Truex Jr. James Small keeps telling him the tires will win out here. He's clearly very quick. He has those four fresh tires versus the two that are in front of him with Larson and Hamlin. Can Truex win back-to-back races for just a second time in his career? Behind them, let's give a tip of the cap to Alex Bowman. Blake Harris with a call to bring him on lap 119, a little bit earlier than everybody else, but it has paid off for the 48, who has not had a top 10 since he returned from his injury. Rick, earlier today, I asked Alex, how have you been feeling? He said, honestly, I'm still not 100%. A little north of 90%, but Bowman could be looking at his first top 10 since breaking his back earlier this year.
Yeah, and that was not in the sprint car, or the cup car, excuse me. That was running a sprint car away from the racetrack for Alex Bowman. Now, Bowman came in earlier than everybody else. Will he be close on fuel? Is he kind of testing the limits?
Well, he came at 119, 41 laps. I assume that the plan was to pit once they were inside their window, so we're going to assume they can make it. Maybe he's banking on a yellow or two. We'll just have to see. There's still 28 to go, so a lot of racing. See what kind of fuel situation he ends up in.
Out in front, it's Tyler Reddick. He has about a 3.5-second lead over Erik Jones, but Reddick all the way down to Yealy. The top eight still have to pit.
You don't have to be in the race to be in the race.
Here comes the 94.
Don't miss your chance to race for the million. Introducing the NASCAR Powerball Playoff.
What a power move.
Enter now for your chance to win a VIP trip for two to the NASCAR Cup Series Championship race at the Phoenix Raceway.
Win in Phoenix.
With the grand prize winner taking home $1 million. Powerball, the official lottery game of NASCAR, and home to the NASCAR Powerball Playoff.
Ray Magliozzi here. eBay Motors has 122 million parts. Let's say you'll need headlights and a bumper. At least you can skip the car wash.
Get the right parts at the right prices. eBay Motors, let's ride.
Advance?
In Advance Auto Parts.
I need that diehard power.
And the reliability and rugged durability, right?
Yes.
That's why diehards choose diehard.
And Advance Auto Parts is the home of Die Hard. We'll even install yours for free.
Yeah. Hey. Abuela? She makes the best tamales.
This is how we advance.
It's orientation day. Welcome to the team.
Race.
I like this team.
Be part of something greater. Toyota. Let's go places.
Cool nights start with Ashley this summer with Tempur-Pedic mattresses starting at $37 per month, Beautyrest Black starting at $45 per month, and Purple starting at $39 per month. Plus, pay 0% interest for 60 months in store only. Only at Ashley.
Stop the things I say and take a look who's playing.
know Monday mornings are the worst. But Monday nights, that's a whole other story. Because that's when Raw is bringing that heat. So you better be watching Raw, only on USA.
It's going to be fast, loud, and definitely a party when IndyCar races on the streets of Nashville. That's Sunday, August 6th. Coverage on NBC and Peacock. Coming off a very successful weekend, the doubleheader in Iowa. Out in front, still Reddick, but we know he will have to come to pit road. Larson has made his way up to seventh now, but he's getting a lot of pressure from the 11 of Denny Hamlin.
19-2, closing in on this battle. Consistently running just a little bit quicker, that 19 car Truex. But now he moves down low, and that tells me he's struggling in traffic. He's struggling running that same groove as the 5 and the 11. He's having to look around to find some clean air for the nose of that car. This is going to be really, really hard to do in terms of any of these guys making a pass, and I love it. It's a challenge, and they're the best. And I want to see him in some of the toughest situations, and this is one of them. So getting a little bit quicker, he got real close to the 5. Now he's backed off a little bit, maybe giving himself an opportunity to cool his tires. Can he make another run? When he does, he'll only have a few corners to pull something off before he cooks the front tires and has to back off again.
Well, you mentioned tires. Just a reminder, right? Larson is on 2 tires. Hamlin is on 2 tires. That's how they leapfrogged in front of Truex. Truex, who was the leader before the cycle, took 4 tires, filled it up with fuel. So he does have a tire advantage and 23 laps. But I agree, Dale, except, you know, still a tall task to get in front of these 2 cars in front of him.
Denny looking like he can't get back to this 5, and it's giving Truex this opportunity here. See the 45. The 45 are ready to come to pit road. The leader of the race, Parker.
Right, they finally said mercy on this one as far as they could on that fuel tank. Maybe they could have got a yellow and maybe had some cars in the back pit and have them restart in the top 20, but it's not going to be the case. You see the 45 Tyler Reddick on pit road getting those 4 tires and filling it full of fuel. As this has not panned out how they wanted, they'll lose a ton of track position here.
Well, let's see where he comes out. Remember, he's going to come out with pressure tires, new tires.
Truex right on the back bumper of that 11 car. Down into turn 1, they're side by side. He won't be able to stay there to be able to side draft the quarter panel down this back straightaway. Falls right back in the line. 11, Denny almost in the fence off of turn 1, pushing as hard as he can.
We now know Truex is faster than Hamlin. Hamlin's going to have to be in full defense mode. Truex knows he needs to get by him as quick as possible because he still has to go up there.
Right now, do you?
There's a little radio communication there about, hey, when he gets that close, he loses the car.
Harrison Burton on pit road now as well. These cars that are in front of Larson are continuing to make their way onto pit road. So now it's LaJoy, Almirola, and Gilliland, the only 3 cars that are in front of Larson.
To your point, Rick, and what Jeff was saying earlier, you had Stenhouse, who's now at 17th. He'll move up to 16th. Eric Jones will move up to 18th. Those are cars that, you know, they ran long. They're going to put some fresh tires on and try to improve their position. I mean, they have 21 laps of racing still in front of them. Those fresher tires are going to, you know, definitely make work for them.
Here's Larson working by slower traffic.
Dale, you and I had this conversation at the Xfinity Series race. I know I take for granted how good these 3 are. Just closing out races. Think about Larson. He for sure isn't probably as fast as the 11 and the 19, but he hasn't missed 6 inches, right? He has shut the door every single corner the last 15 laps, and he's going to have to do 60 more perfect corners to stay in front of these 2.
Yeah, it's impressive how elite they are as drivers and athletes. You see the lap car pointing by Denny Hamlin down to the inside of turn 1. Truex is going to want that same opportunity here for corner exit. But, you see the same guys finish these races out week in and week out. It's racecraft. You know, understanding throughout the entire event where you are, who you're racing. We heard some great commentary from the 12-car Blaney. Do I race hard? Do I pass this car? Do I sit here? He's in tune with his crew chief. trying to figure out how hard to push his car and take care of it to get it to the finish line. And now we see these three guys here trying to battle it out for the win. Kim.
Kyle Larson currently running in that fourth position with word from the team that the three cars in front of you have to pit. And we went over in our through the field the fact that Cliff Daniels did the math, told his driver they were going to be in the prime position to be out front after green flag stops. And that plays exactly into what Cliff Daniels told me this morning. He said it does not matter what happens to you throughout the race. This is a track where you always have a chance. You are never out of it. Proving it here today, he got into an early incident. Now finds himself after the first three cars pit at the point, Parker.
Right, the driver he's been trying to hold off is that number 11 of Denny Hamlin, who started this race a very loose, and they sort of made small adjustments. Chris Gabehart asked him maybe what would help you in traffic. He said, I still need to be snugger, but as I watch him here following that five and now starting to lose a little bit of distance to that five, it just looks like he's been struggling to get that car to go to a different groove and work for him, aside from being able to get some clean air and get by that five car. So right now, just not having the handling he wants inside the 11 car to go challenge the five, Marty.
Parker, 18 laps to go, about to be 17 when Kyle Larson crosses the line right here. So here's a problem for Martin Truex Jr. He just has no grip at all once he gets up behind his teammate, Denny Hamlin. And he made the comment that when I get close to those cars in front of me, I'm just burning the fronts off my car. Clearly, that tire advantage, Jeff, has gone now. Remember, they took four for Truex on that last stop. So how do you not burn the front tires off of it, but also try to get by your teammate and Kyle Larson as well?
All you can do is try to run a different line than they're running, try to get clean air on that race car, but you got to push. You got to drive, be in that throttle, pushing hard.
Caution's out.
That guy.
Caution's out to 14 of Chase Briscoe is around. He came out of turn four or three, and around he went. Now, there'll be another restart, and we have seen chaos on restarts today.
Well, pretty heavy damage to the back of that car.
Been a tough day for Chase and this team. They were running 30th, just have not had the speed.
Yeah, they hit that top 10 a week ago at New Hampshire. I know that they were hoping that was going to be the moment, right, where the field, the season kind of flipped. Let's just take a look. Oh, boy.
Oh, wow. Yeah, looks like he got a little help there from the 77.
Ty Dillon was on the back bumper.
So I wonder what happened a few laps before.
Yeah, there's definitely. Kind of, yes.
That definitely had to have been a couple things going on during the lap to.
We jumped to like chapter two of that book. There's a chapter one somewhere. We're going to have to go find it. Now with 17 to go, you see the damage, right? LaJoy and Almirola have to pit and Gilliland because they need fuel. I assume Larson, Hamlin, Truex are going to keep the track position, but somewhere back there, someone thinks tires are going to be an advantage. And you got Stenhouse and Erik Jones that ran long. Reddick ran long. The reason I say that, they have pretty fresh tires. Like, Reddick's only been on the racetrack for basically four or five laps. So, you know, we're going to have to, this will definitely jumble up the order a little bit. I don't think it will change for the 5, the 11, and the 19. And then I have zero predictions on the restart because I've seen Byron lose the lead twice on restarts, and we couldn't even get stage two going because they kept wrecking.
Well, remember, Kyle Larson was running second when he spun on a restart and slid up the racetrack in turn number one. So the top three, LaJoy, Almirola, and Gilliland, we will anticipate their trip onto pit road right there. And that now puts the lead back in the hands of Kyle Larson as they get ready for the restart. Kim.
You see Corey LaJoy in that 7 car. He was complaining of a tight condition. You see the chassis adjustment going to happen, that wrench going in. They'll change 4 tires, take Sunoco fuel as they make that quick adjustment.
Also on pit road here, you see Chase Elliott in the 9 cars. We see a lot of the field in the back coming down to put 4 tires on, maybe tires mattering more than it looked like earlier in this race, Marty.
Interesting call by Rudy Fugel here. This is what happens when you have 4 wins in the bank. Right, Steve, you come down pit road here. I believe he was running 4th at the time. Talked about how tough the handling is when he's back in traffic. We'll see what those 4 fresh Goodyear tires do, though. This is interesting. Certainly changed up the game here with 16 to go.
Yeah, we're going to cycle this all around and kind of reset the field.
looked like about 14 cars stayed out. I was trying to do the math quickly there, but about 14, which gives these guys a little bit of a cushion on those fresh tires.
I just use the old, I'm just going to let it cycle back around and let the timing screen tell me, Rick. I'm not going to try to pretend that I can count that fast anymore. I know the who did stay out, and that's, you know, Larson. You see him right there in the five on two tires. I think cooling will help those two tires. Hamlin, those two tires cooling off. Truex is hoping to get a good start and find some space. He's been trapped behind him. And don't sleep on Bowman, right? This is a driver who had missed a couple races due to injury, and his lap times looked pretty good on four tires as well. So Kevin Harvick, he's on two tires, right? And this is a guy looking for a win in his, you said it right, on the walk of the grid, Jeff, right? He's looking for a win in his final year.
Yeah, you know how bad he wants it. He's super competitive. I mean, in his last year, he still has that same competitive fire. You know, he wants to make some stuff happen. You know he's going to be pushing the buttons.
All right, while we have a break in the action, let's check in on the Peacock Pit Box with Kyle Petty. Okay, Kyle Larson is going to be up front. KP, are we going to see Kyle Larson get to victory lane, or is he going to have a little trouble maybe with the two guys that have been battling the tightest behind him?
It's all about the restarts. We're back to the restarts again. Can he get that? We've seen William Byron lose the lead on a couple of restarts, so that's going to be critical. But listen, Kyle Larson's day, he's already a winner. Remember, he's sitting backwards in the wall earlier in the race. We just got up against it where he got respun right there. You look at that. I applaud Cliff Daniels. Cliff Daniels has done a tremendous job on numerous times throughout the career of Kyle Larson on having an early spin, having an early accident, keeping his nose down, picking up a different strategy, playing that strategy out, and beating these other guys. This has been the perfect day for these guys to be able to be off kilter just a little bit and put themselves in position to win, Marty.
KP, let's chat with James Small, trying to win back-to-back races for Martin Truex Jr. Does this caution help or hurt you?
I actually think it helps us. You know, it's obviously we drove up to the back of him there and just you can't get anywhere. So at least this kind of lets us reset here and maybe get a run on the out of turn one. And we started to get a little bit tight there, so just following so much. So I think allow the fronts to cool back down and maybe go at it again.
This is a good time to remind Martin it took three restarts at the end of the race last week, or on Monday, I should say, to win it.
Yeah, actually it is, so I might well do that.
There you go, James Small, going to remind his driver only a few days ago, Parker, that he made it happen at New Hampshire. Can they get back-to-back wins? We'll find out.
And the crew chief for Denny Hamlin, Chris Gabehart here. You guys got off strategy a little bit by going too early in one of the stops, so you covered here to be in second place. A great recovery for you guys.
Yeah, I don't know if we ever got off strategy. There were stage points out there and a stage win to go get, and we pit on the number that we wanted to pit on, so we had this option for later. I mean, it was all laying there, fortunately. The tough thing about Pocono is sometimes you get whammied on something you weren't expecting, but honestly, this played out right like we hoped.
And do you guys have the car to pass the five?
Whoever's got the clean air is king, man. Hopefully we can get it.
We'll see, Kim.
And Cliff Daniels calls the shots for Kyle Larson. At the beginning of the day, you said you're never out of it at Pocono. You guys proving it here today. What are you telling your driver on this restart?
Yeah, I mean, certainly we had a more eventful day than what we would have liked, but the HenderCars.com Chevrolet team, they've done a great job battling through it. Obviously, Kyle's done a great job on the track, and yeah, we'll see where it goes. We'll be taking the green with 13 to go here. You know, I think our car's okay. Obviously, us and the 11 are on rights, and we got a bunch of guys on four, but nobody else you'd rather have in your seat right now than Kyle Larson, and we're just going to go for it.
A lot of confidence from Cliff Daniels and his driver and what he's able to do on this restart.
Interesting right here.
Yeah, I thought so, too.
Watching the chews, Rick. The teammates, Joe Gibbs teammates split up. Denny goes to the bottom, Truex to the top. The pushers in lane two, and even in lane three we've seen today, are critical. If you can connect three cars, it's better than two. Which lane can do that and stay connected all the way down into turn one?
So how selfish are you going to be? Because that's ultimately what ends up happening here. When you have Larson with a Truex behind him and Hamlin with a Bowman behind him, those two guys are wanting to win this race.
Well, you also have 13 laps to go. We take the green, and I'm not, you know, I do agree that clean air is king, but let's not forget that you got the group right here, Reddick down to Harrison. They have fresher tires. Then behind them you have Gregson, Bell, Gilliland, Almirola, Chastain, all these guys that have fresher tires. I don't know if they can just pull right up there, but those pushes, Dale, could really affect us. Let's listen into the 11.
Look at how rough, by the way, that tunnel turn is. Man.
Often.
So the last two restarts, the bottom front row has cleared for P2. That's why
Mike is the 19, not the first of five.
Uh-huh. That's what we were thinking about. Two by two. Larson will be on the outside. Denny Hamlin on the inside. Hamlin is a six-time winner here at Pocono. Larson has finished second twice. Back into the gas they go. 13 laps to go at Pocono.
Good push on the outside. You see it. Bowman not able to get to the back of Denny Hamlin. They're going to lose a few spots before they get to turn one.
Oh, check it up in the outside lane. Ty Gibbs had a little bit of issue there.
Three wide back there for sixth.
Reddick right in the middle of that. Sandwich.
Oh, running.
Contact back there. Things getting dicey in the back.
Martin Truex Jr. up to second now. Still three wide as they go through the tunnel turn. Not very often do you see that happen here at Pocono.
Not successfully.
Through three, and they stay three wide. Out in front, coming up on 12 to go. Two car lengths separating the top two, Larson and Truex Jr.
So now Truex is in second place. Doesn't have the car of Denny Hamlin between him and the lead car. That would have been much dirtier air than what he's undergoing right here. But he needs to attack. He needs to attack while he can. Every corner that goes by is better for Larson. That's going to heat those front tires on that 19, as we've heard, and get that car tighter and tighter, make it harder and harder for Truex to put any runs together. And the 5 car just needs to concentrate on corner exit. He has the dirty air to his advantage. Make sure you exit the corner. Don't worry about charging the entry. Give up a little bit on entry if you need to, just to throttle up and beat the car behind you off the corner all the way down the straightaway.
Oh, around goes a car in the back. The 48 of Bowman spins and brings the caution out. He was running in the third position, and around he went.
That's a tough break for the 48. I mean, his last top five was all the way back at COTA in March. He has not had a top five since returning from injury. He was in position today to get one. Let's see what happens.
Looks like he's chasing the back of the car and just loses it. Denny's giving him some time, trying to allow him to gather the car up. And you can see Denny's allowing other cars to get underneath him. So 11 checks up, trying to help the 48. But I don't know if there was an issue, a flat tire, or, whatever was going on there. But the 48 goes in the corner and loses it.
Do you remember what Martin Truex Jr. said when the late caution came out when his teammate spun? He said there needs to be a company policy. Teammates shouldn't spin when we're out front.
See, the 48 sideways. I just was making sure we didn't have contact there, but usually we've heard that these cars don't get too affected by cars being right behind them, but certainly the 48 losing rear traction.
Bowman on the radio said Denny wrecked him.
Yeah, I mean, he probably... Well, look at that. I mean, there's no contact, so...
By the way, I'm pretty sure he just got loose, by the way. Yeah, they're showing on TV. You were 6 inches on the bumper.
Yeah, what happens from the seat is that you feel like you're under control. You know somebody's right underneath you. Then all of a sudden, the thing turns around, and you're like, there's no way I wasn't contacted. There's no way. It just came around so quickly. So Alex believes that there's contact here because it just got away from him so rapidly, and he just can't believe it didn't happen without it because somebody hit him. But we clearly could see that there was no contact.
Well, that's why I like it at real time, because in slow-mo you could kind of break it down, but you just heard both drivers have a very, you know, an opinion on what happened, and they don't honestly know, right? If Bowman thinks that the 11 wrecked him, I'm confident to say there was gap the whole time. And Denny was even like, I'm pretty sure he was loose. I didn't feel like I touched him. I mean, it happened so fast.
These two drivers have had, well, an interesting couple of last races. We go back to the streets of Chicago, where Denny got into the back of Bowman there in turn 11. That was right in front of you there, Jeff. And Bowman created a little bit of an obstacle there in that turn. And then Atlanta, where you see Bowman coming up, and he tags the 11 here. Car getting loose on him. So the last few races, the 48 and 11, have been awfully close to each other when there has been an incident.
Yeah, this is really frustrating for Alex Bowman. You mentioned it earlier, but since he's come back from injury, there's not been rhythm. There's not been consistency of race finishes, consistency of speed, and he's spoken openly about it. We've got to be better. And then on a day where he feels looks like he's going to get a good finish, loses the car all by himself. And things like this, Junior, we've been through it, are crushing to your confidence. They make you think, what's wrong? Why can't I get this thing done? And it is tough to overcome, but you just got to keep fighting.
Yeah, it is tough to overcome. It can last for a really long time, and you just want to go to the next race and hope that you get that top 10 or that top 5 finish, and something to break that cycle.
All right, Kim, you've been there bunkered down with the 5 team pretty much the whole race. What are you thinking about the finish of this one?
I don't know, we're going to have to wait and see, but you heard the confidence from crew chief Cliff Daniels on what his driver can do. We saw what Kyle could do on the restart. His crew chief telling him, just do what you did again and again. There might be more restarts. And with that, they've told Kyle to save fuel. He was the first one on pit road during green flag stops last time. 120. They feel good about their fuel situation, but if we see a flurry of green and white checkers at the end here, they are close to being out on fuel, Marty.
Kim, Martin Truex Jr. trying for his third Pocono win and his fourth win of 2023. Now the big question for the 19 team is lane selection. Long conversation a moment ago. James Small asked Truex, can we trust the 45 or the 4 to push us? Thinking maybe going a different direction than his teammate Denny Hamlin, or Hamlin will select something different behind him. And then they said, you know what, Martin? We're leaving it up to you. This is all on you. Your call on what lane you want to pick.
I wouldn't trust the 45 of Reddick because of the new tires he has.
Parker.
And guys, I just want to chime in on Tyler Reddick, who at lap 138, when he pitted under green for 4 tires, I thought he was finished. He went outside the top 15, but now lining up in the top 5 with the newest tires of anyone in the top 5, it shows what I know. I think he's got a great shot and has the speed in that 45 car to go challenge those front 3.
So the 11 and the 48 are having a little difference of opinion. And next weekend, we're at a short track for the Cup Series, Road America for the Xfinity Series. Road America will see countdown to green at 2:30 and 3 o'clock for the Xfinity Series. That's on NBC and Peacock. And the reason I brought up the 11 and 48, I'm going to put the odds right now at even that the 11 and 48 will start the race side by side.
At Richmond?
At Richmond. When they have a difference, it seems like they are right next to each other.
Every time you're in a disagreement with somebody, you end up being in the same truck during driver's intros.
Right.
And you're like, you're the last person I want to talk to. And I'm in proximity, and I'm going to have to.
You hate it, and the fans love it.
All right, I'm going to put you all on the spot here, guys. I want to know. They left it up to Truex. Truex lined up on the outside behind Larson, pushed his way to second without a problem. Are you front row?
Well,
are you second on the outside?
I don't.
We're about to find out.
Yeah. Not going to give you an answer. You're going to get it right here.
Front row. I'm going front row.
Yeah, the 19 looks like he's going low, but if he goes low, then he goes high, maybe? I don't know. Yep. That was the challenge, right? Is if Truex takes the top, then he goes to the front row, and it's all over again, right? And the best Truex can get is second place, right? Coming off turn 2. He wants a shot at trying to beat this 5 car squared up here.
The danger in picking the bottom is that Tyler Reddick is lining up behind you. You know how aggressive he is. He's got a little newer tire that may allow him to launch a little better, get some momentum on Truex, and then make it 3 wide getting into the corner. When you're on the outside, it's easier to protect someone trying to get on the outside of you. But if you're Truex, the pathway to winning is on the inside line because now you're beside Larson. And you just heard Chris Gabehart, the crew chief of the 11 car, say clean air is king. So when you start on the bottom, Marty, you have that clean air. Martin's got to try to find a way to get a great launch right here.
Jeff, here's the radio conversation between Martin Truex Jr. and his spotter about going with the low line. Listen.
I don't know. You know, if we go bottom 11, goes top, 45 pushes us, we don't get going, we're going to end up third. If we do go top and come out second, I feel like we have a better opportunity to go, but if the 5 makes a mistake and we're on the bottom, we get clear and get out front. So kind of whatever you think.
And Martin Truex Jr.'s answer to that was, we have to stay aggressive. Third buys us nothing. We need a win right here. So that's the aggressive move, in his opinion, Jeff. Go with that low line in the front row.
Well, the other thing is he's been able to pass him from behind. Like, you know, yeah, you might come out second, but we haven't seen evidence that he has enough speed to get by. He said he'd burn up his front tires earlier, so I think this is his shot.
Jeff, you mentioned it too. Tyler Reddick, he could leave the 19 hanging. I mean, if he feels like he has a car that could potentially get up there, instead of push that 19, duck to the inside, try to pass him before they get to turn one.
On options.
Pace car off. It'll be seven laps. A sprint to the finish, and the crowd is loving it here at Pocono.
Good push at the outside line. Reddick is not to the back of the 19. The outside line's going to have the speed, the momentum down into turn one.
Reddick not even close to the back of the 19. The 11 clears him, and now here comes Denny Hamlin to the inside for the lead through one.
He runs the five wide, almost into the fence.
Up into the wall with the five, and now the momentum behind them with the 19 of Martin Truex Jr. Larson loses the lead. Hamlin's out front.
Oh, we got a crash behind him into the tunnel turn. A big wreck. Hard, hard lick.
That's Haley in the 31, and he has turned around. A lot of damage to the driver's side of the 31. And so the caution comes out once again. Harvick was also up there in the top three. Great to see the window net come down for Haley.
Yeah, I saw him get turned right across traffic, headed into the tunnel turn.
I don't think Larson was happy with the way Hamlin raced him, and he just went by the start finish line.
Yeah, Denny gassed it up in the middle of the corner. This is after the yellow. Look at that. Wow. He is angry. So we'd like to see the restart to where we can watch Denny. He, in the middle of the corner, gets position on the five, then just throttles up, really, and drives up the racetrack, carrying the five up the racetrack. We saw this before, but it was Ross Chastain on the outside last year. Again, the five hard into the wall. Literally almost the same exact scenario. He comes down the racetrack trying to slow Denny down.
Yeah, you don't mind getting run up the racetrack a little bit, but when you get run up the racetrack this much to where now there's contact and it pushes you out of the groove, you have no choice but to lift out of the throttle, and you're still going to hit the wall. So, yeah, I don't blame him. I'd be mad too.
We saw it out of Ross Chastain, or with Ross Chastain last year. Hamlin did the same move, and now you see the frustration from Larson running into the side of the 11. Take a look at this wreck, though, for Haley. Already around backwards.
That's a scary impact. Left side driver first into the wall.
And thankfully, he hit earlier in the turn than at the exit of turn two. He was riding the wall through turn two, but a lot of damage and heavy contact for the 31 of Haley. So now less than five laps to go. And we mentioned Ross and Denny, and you're going to say deja vu, because take a look at how this one ended up.
It looks just about the same, other than Ross came back across the racetrack and collected other drivers with him.
It ended Ross Chastain's day, and this was just moments ago.
Then he said it worked last year. Let's do it again.
Yeah, they get together and up the racetrack. Denny and him both now are out of the gas. Big run's coming behind them. They're going to both drive down the racetrack to try to block that run. But the five knows he got used up a little bit there, and he's frustrated and mad about it.
Yeah, a lot of speed scrubbed off of the five after he hit the wall. A allowed the four to get by. And then this was, again, out under caution. The five comes over, bumps into the side of the 11 of Denny Hamlin, showing the displeasure. Harvick's vantage point.
Yeah. Harvick said, I've seen this before.
Yeah. He was the poor guy that hit Chastain.
He was.
I bet.
So let's listen in to the radio, and we're going to start with the 11 of Denny Hamlin.
I know he's your buddy and all, but good grief, man. Have we seen the stuff he does to people?
He got a lane. There was more than a lane. It's his choice to stay in it.
Well, we didn't say a word on our radio, but wait till you hear they talk on their radio. I'll just leave it at that.
And that's why this place is sold out.
Yes.
I mean, right? I mean.
Next week's a big crowd, too.
Yes. As I mentioned, the 48, that issue of where he was going to line up, well, the 5 might line up right there as well.
Truex going to take another stab at the inside here. The 4 car of Harvick in that outside groove. And Larson probably still fuming over that last restart. Going to take the inside behind Truex. Kim.
And Kevin Harvick looking for a win in his final season. So let's talk to crew chief Rodney Childers. How are you guys feeling about your chances here in these last laps at Pocono?
Yeah, we've had a great race car all weekend long, and kind of made a bad call there at the beginning and put us in a bad spot, and seemed like people didn't do what I thought they were going to do. But overall, everybody's done a good job of fighting back and putting us in a position here. We'll just have to see how this restart goes. Our car hasn't went very good on every restart, but it's been a little bit better on scuffed tires, so hopefully we can hang in there.
With it being Kevin's last season, what would a win mean for this team?
Well, it would mean everything, you know. I mean, just to get a win with him in his last season, but also lock us into those playoffs and make it where we can just go race these next few.
All right, we'll see what Kevin Harvick can do on this restart.
Thanks, Kim. All right, you guys, make sure you join me. NBC Sports on SiriusXM on Wednesday, 9 a.m. Eastern. I will join the morning drive. That's NASCAR Radio Channel 90, NBC Sports on SiriusXM. And I know what we're going to be talking about as we get ready for the restart.
Yeah, so I have to wonder how much damage there is to Larson's car. Will his car be able to take off here? Think about this. These restarts are aggressive. 4 times a day, they haven't made a lap after a restart before caution was having to be thrown. The aggression level is going to get even higher.
Great opportunity to do something about it right here.
That was Cliff Daniels, crew chief for the 5 of Larson. Let's see if he does something. Now up front, Hamlin has Harvick behind him. Martin Truex Jr. on the inside. Joe Gibbs Racing side by side.
That inside line just fails to connect every single restart. Truex side drafting hard. Here comes the 45 to the inside. Reddick
couldn't get to the 19, and now Reddick drops back to 4th. And 2 car lengths separate Hamlin from Martin Truex Jr. They're 1 and 2, under 3 laps to go.
Larson on the bottom. Wonder if his car is not driving well. Falling back.
Denny Hamlin, a 6-time winner at Pocono, looking for number 7. Martin Truex Jr. won a week ago. And New Hampshire looking to go back-to-back. And Toyota running top 2 right now, looking for their 600th win in NASCAR's top 3 series.
And they're trying to take 3rd place. Reddick to the inside of Harvick down here in turn 1 and 2. Not going to get cleared. Nose to nose off in the corner. Harvick backs off. Reddick with the newer tires clears into 3rd place.
Reddick on the move up to 3rd. Now they fan out. The top 7, nose to tail. Erik Jones trying to stick the nose out of the 43. Seeing if he can get another spot. See Chase Elliott just behind him.
Truex not able to close the gap. Oh, there's a spin. The 41 of Priest is around. No caution yet.
No, he's not going to make contact with the inside wall, and no caution has come out.
Reddick to the inside for 2nd.
left. One lap to go. Presented by Credit One Bank.
Drag race down the front straightaway for second place between Reddick and Truex. The 41 still sitting there, not refired.
Now he gets going. Trying to get going. You see the flames coming out of the exhaust of the 41. He can't get it refired.
They need to throw a caution right here.
The caution does come out. That will put Denny Hamlin in victory lane. Win number 60. And the crowd not happy.
Yeah, that's 5-0. The right thing to do. That is 100% the right thing to do. You cannot let those cars go by him sitting in the racetrack like that. You don't have a choice. We all hate it, but there is no choice right there.
I don't believe that's what they're booing.
Way to go, guys.
I don't think that's what they're booing, buddy.
Well, I hope not.
No. I mean, that was the right call. The car can't be sitting there. Somebody gets turned around coming out of that tunnel turn. You can hear the fans frustrated.
Win 50 comes at the boos of Pocono fans. The crowd maybe not so happy at how Denny Hamlin ended up winning this race.
Well, we're going when he gets out of that car.
We're going to know.
Yeah.
50 wins for Denny Hamlin. 600 wins for Toyota. Ty Gibbs coming by to congratulate him. The 42-year-old from Chesterfield, Virginia. Now 7 times he has been to victory lane at Pocono. And you mentioned it when he comes back around.
Thank you for letting us do this. We love you. And thank you for Jesus. Amen.
Yes!
So Joe Gibbs Racing goes back to back. Martin Truex Jr. a week ago, and now Denny Hamlin this week. Checkered flag moment brought to you by Advance Auto Parts, and we'll see just how loud the crowd gets now with Denny back on the front stretch. A bottle even just came from the grandstands. Not happy about that. That's not the way you show displeasure.
There are some fans that are happy, but I think he's lost the majority.
It was a couple years ago at Martinsville. He ran Chase Elliott up into the wall, and the crowd let them know they weren't happy about it. And now, well, he's gotten out of the car. Marty, it's pretty loud.
The boos cascading down from the Pocono race fans today. Denny Hamlin got his first win here. Win number 50 in his career here, and win number 600 for Toyota. But the talk will be about the move with Kyle Larson and running him up on that restart. Denny, did he have a right to be mad at you?
Well, both guys wrecked themselves. There was the lane. He missed the corner first, and evidently he didn't have his right side tires clean. And when he gassed up, he just kept going again. You have an option in those positions to either hold it wide open and hit the fence, or lift and race it out. But those are choices they made. I didn't hit either one of them. Didn't touch them.
On a monumental day for you, win number 50. What does it mean to do it? A, here, but B, with all the boos, from the fans at one of your favorite places.
I love it. They can boo my rock out here in a few years.
How improbable at times today, Denny, did this win seem to you?
Well, I thought we had the best car, honestly. We had the best car. The strategy worked out well. Chris just kept getting me more towards the front. This Mavis tire and brakes car was just really fast right from the get-go in practice, and just really happy that finally winning these races that we should win.
The rock, he mentions all the winners here at Pocono and all-time greats get a rock here just outside the garage area. He'll probably have that someday. Now it's the all-time winner at Pocono with 7, but this is not a popular win with the fans here in Pocono, Rick.
Not at all, and they are voicing their opinion on how they feel like he was able to get this win. Well, it is win number 50, and it comes with an incredible career, a Hall of Fame career for Denny Hamlin, which really may have been thrust into the spotlight at Pocono when he won his rookie season here, swept that year. He's won Daytona 500s, and now 7 times in Pocono, 50 wins on the career for Denny Hamlin. It's the NASCAR America post-race show presented by Progressive. Our post-race coverage now also available on Peacock, where each week we're going to bring you the NASCAR America post-race show presented by Progressive, guaranteed for at least 30 minutes. And we're going to hear from a few different drivers, and we're going to start with probably the most popular one here at Pocono of Kyle Larson, and he's with Kia.
Yeah, we saw that aggressive racing between the 11 of Denny Hamlin and you. Assess what happened. Was there somebody in the right and somebody in the wrong?
Well, first off, just really proud of my team to even get us in position to race for a win. I mean, we got spun early, and car wasn't the same after that, but they played the strategy really well to get us up there. So just unfortunate, but I've been cost a lot of good finishes by him throughout my career, and I know he says I race a certain way, but I don't think I've ever had to apologize to him about anything. So, not that I'm sure he's gonna say sorry after this, but is what it is. So, whatever, just move on. Try to go to, I don't even know where we're at next week. Richmond, I think, and I guess we won there earlier this year, so try and get a good run in. But thanks to the crowd here in Pennsylvania. I got a lot of support here in PA, so. Always love coming here.
You and Denny are friends off the racetrack. Do you have an inclination to reach out to him or just kind of wait and see? I know you said you don't think he'll apologize.
No, I mean, it is what it is. Like, yeah, we're friends. Yes, this makes things shitty and awkward, but, you know, whatever. You know, he's always right. All the buddies know Denny's always right. So I'm sure he was in the right there as well. But, you know, it is what it is. I'm not going to let it, you know, tarnish a friendship on track, but I am pissed. So, and I feel like I should be pissed, but I'm sure tuning into action is detrimental. He'll have a long clip about it.
Do you race him differently on track then?
I think at this point I have to, right? Like I said, I've never had to apologize to him about anything I've done on the racetrack. I can count 4 or 5 times where he's had to reach out to me to be like, oh man, sorry, I put you in a bad spot there or whatever. And so eventually, like he says, you know, you got to start racing people a certain way to get the respect back. So, I mean, he pulled the same move on Ross last year, which Ross probably deserved it, right? With all the stuff that he's done to Denny in his career. Again, I haven't done that to Denny. So I don't think I deserve to be, you know, run into before I ever got to the wall. So just it is what it is. I'm going to go race the sprint car on Tuesday night. I'm going to forget about it here in a few hours. And, that's the best medicine for a tough result. So look forward to getting the 57 sprint car on Tuesday at Grandview, and you move on to Richmond.
A very frustrated Kyle Larson comes home in the 21st position.
So while Denny is celebrating in victory lane, Kyle Larson ended up 21st in this race. Take another look. Denny said he never hit him. It looks like contact is happening right there.
There's contact, yeah. I mean, they definitely come together, and Denny takes what he needs. He's coming up the racetrack. The five sort of running his lane, and Denny just kind of, I mean, look, there's a lot of room there between the two cars, but there was contact, and it did send the five up into the fence. Denny thinks the five could have lifted and saved his car, but the five thinks, hey, man, you put me in that situation to begin with. It's your responsibility to take better care of me and not put me in that situation.
Yeah, when somebody runs into the side of you, the option shouldn't be just to lift. Here's what caused the caution. Here's the 41 car of Ryan Preece, right? And NASCAR held this caution. We've been seeing them do this earlier in the race. They held the caution, waiting to see if Ryan could get his car fired up. And at one point, it looked like it got fired up and started rolling, and then it stopped. And so then NASCAR was forced to throw the caution. That's, you know, looking back on it, when immediately it happened, in retrospect, they should have thrown the caution, but giving him a chance to try to get going again so they can get a race to the finish. I applaud them to try to give the fans a race to the finish.
And why is this different than you might see next week? It's the size of the racetrack. They have more time here to react, more time to decide how a situation is serious or not, as opposed to at Richmond or Bristol, that car sitting over there would have been an automatic yellow. And so at such a large racetrack, they're given chances to allow drivers to race it out to the last possible moment. If the 41 gets going, we go to green all the way to the checkered. In this case, wasn't able to do that.
Larson's going to continue to be interviewed, as is Hamlin. Hamlin climbed out of the car in victory lane, and the boos continue.
NASCAR America post-race show is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Save when you bundle auto, home, or motorcycle insurance. Visit progressive.com. Marty Sider and Kyle Petty joining you here on the Peacock Pit Box. And I think the one important point to make here, Kyle, as we continue the talk after Denny Hamlin wins, all-time now winner here at Pocono with 7 wins.
Incredible.
Yeah, an incredible, incredible feat.
That
period.
Is. 50 wins
career
that.
Wins.
That's incredible.
Toyota, that's 600 wins. All that aside, I think the one point that stood out to me, you never, never see Kyle Larson that mad.
No.
He can blow off things that happen to him and say, hey, it's racing, it happens. He did not do that today against one of his better friends in the garage area, Denny Hamlin.
Yeah, just and listen, he just kept talking to Kim. Kim did a great job. She asked great question, Kim Coon. But we see here, this is a replay of Denny Hamlin and Ross Chastain last year. He's already pulled this move. Denny can't be the victim. We played his radio. He was the victim. He puts himself in the victim position. Hey, you're not the victim here, Denny Hamlin. And when I looked at this one and we heard what Kyle Larson said, he said, Denny's always right. All his buddies know it. And he laughed about it because he knows Denny's not going to apologize for this. You see him come back here. It was a great race, man. I enjoyed every lap. I loved the strategy. I loved everything about it. The ending, I don't appreciate. I don't appreciate even 50 wins, what he's done. I don't appreciate that because we saw this same move last year, and that's just my opinion.
I think the crazy part is he's been such a popular driver
yes.
here forever, and they resoundingly booed him. Should he show more remorse for this win?
No. He's not going to. That's not Denny.
Well, you know, should he?
Yeah, listen, he's not going to. I'm not even going to go down that highway with you because that's not Denny Hamlin's personality. Kyle Larson said it. Denny's always right. People that are always right don't have remorse. They just go ahead and live their life in their world, and that's what Denny does, and that's fine because he is an incredible race car driver. He's able to take that and put it somewhere, and it's win at all costs, and we saw it here.
5 races now left in the regular season, Kyle. Here's how the playoff standings shape up heading to Richmond next weekend.
Yeah, pretty impressive. And listen, I said Denny needed to win this race to establish himself to get to Phoenix. I don't like the way he won it, but I do appreciate that. William Byron had strong runs. Martin Truex, Kyle Busch is the only guy in that top five that didn't really show up here. But those first 4 or 5 guys have established them guys as they are the guys you're going to have to go through.
Well, look at Bubba Wallace gaining some points today. Michael McDowell as well. Denny Hamlin winds up with his 50th career win. It comes here at Pocono. More NASCAR and motorsports coverage always available on NBC. NBCSports.com. Post-race coverage will continue on Peacock. Flip over there. Coming up next on USA Law & Order.